business. Item 5.1, present the pet available for adoption at the city animal shelter.
Now, tonight we have a little Chihuahua mix that we named Oscar, and he's tan and white. He's about a year old, and he's a really nice dog. He'll be up for adoption tomorrow at the animal shelter along with these friends. And we're in the 1200 block of South 10th. Phone number is 249-4910. And we open at 10 o'clock until 6. Thank you very much.
Thank you. It's a big dog. Item 5.2, we have a presentation for Beagle Marketing. Frank?
And Commissioner Stuber, Oscar was looking at you like he'd be willing to go out campaigning with you. So if you want to go get a companion.
I'll keep that in mind.
Well, guys, I wanted to stop in just briefly, and we've already presented some plaques. In fact, I will show this for the camera. To the other members of the City Commission, City Manager Eric Benson, Joan Riley, Parks and Recreation, and we've got some others to present to other departments of the city for the enormous help that the City of Enid has provided in the 9 years of our Roberts Ranch Smoke and Red Dirt Barbecue. Lynn Binkendorf, who is really the heart and soul of this, is going to have some specifics on the dollars raised this year to a wide variety of nonprofits. But we really, really couldn't do this without the city's work from all levels, whether it's a call to a Joan Riley or IT people or folks in the trenches with electrical work. It's just been outstanding. So, Lynn, I'll turn it over to you. And Mayor Shuey, I will present you with your own little plaque here.
Yes, as I can, on behalf of Enid News and Eagle and Eagle Marketing and Enid and Ambex, we want to say thank you to the city and the community for doing everything that they possibly can. It has been a successful event, and like Frank had mentioned, it's a lot of departments that have put their heart and soul into it. And I want to give a shout out to Roy Robbins and his group at the technical, and congratulations. Thank you, Mayor Shuey, for everything that you've done and for stepping in and visiting with the cooks. We really appreciate all what you did when you come in and talk to them, so thank you very much. We're looking for the barbecue is great too.
Priorities.
Yes, it always is. Some numbers this year, which is kind of nice, is this year was our biggest year yet. We had 70 teams. They came from Colorado to Rhode Island and Florida and points in between. So with the teams and the cooks, we had folks come in from out of town and out of state, roughly around 350 folks. This year, we had three different entities or parts of the event. The first was on Thursday evening, we had the March of Dimes Little Miss Red Dirt Pageant, which was in its second year, and they raised $12,700 for that event during the barbecue. We also, let me back up, started out earlier in the month with the Pioneer Cellular Youth Arts Festival. This is our fifth year for that. And we are thankful for Pioneer Cellular and with their donation, and we had 150 students from Northwest Oklahoma that participated, we were able to give $4,000 back to the area schools for their art departments and for the youth. And then we were just 2 weeks ago at the Enid and Ambex meeting, and they actually announced that they raised $16,700 from the Red Dirt Barbecue. So all told, this event for a little bit barbecue, Mayor, that you enjoy, raised over $33,000 for our community. So because of your commitment and your dedication and to our sponsors and the community itself, we want to thank you for that. And we're looking forward to year 10. Next year's year 10, and we've already talked to Jacob and Cole. Jacob did a wonderful job this year with the Parks and Recreation, coordinating all the departments, and we want to say thanks to him. And I already told Cole that we were going to become best of friends this year, talking to him about everything for year 10. And like I said earlier, I wanted to give a shout out to Roy Robbins and his group with the technical department. And like Frank had mentioned, all the electrical was outstanding. Frank Sweet was on call, and I think I called him about 10 times that day. So again, thank you to the city, the commissioners. We appreciate everything you do. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
And just one final quick thing, just in terms of tourism outreach and public relations, Mayor Shuey is always kind enough to come down and address the judges. We have about 300 team members from the various barbecue teams, and there was a young guy from UConn, and of course, you know Bill, he likes to work the tables after he's talked to the crowd, and so he was passing amongst them at a local establishment, and a young guy came up to me the next day and said, "Oh my God, I had a beer with the mayor of Enid." So, Bill Shuey, PR God. Thank you, sir.
Barbecue was great, and the beer was even better.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
It's a good deal.
Mr. Mayor, I have a proclamation, but before I, as I, Steve, as I make my way down there, you have a couple of introductions to make, don't you?
Yes. Mr. Mayor and commissioners, Mr. Renson had asked me to, I guess in the tradition of recognizing the young individuals that really keep things going for us, Susanna, you want to work your way up here, please? This is Susanna Davidson, and then Sam Smoker. Sam, you want to come up here if you would, please? Eric wanted to take a few moments and recognize these individuals that they're always behind the camera, providing the City Commission meetings for everyone and televise that. Susanna is going to that school in Stillwater at Oklahoma State University. She's going to go to veterinary school, so congratulations. And Sam wanted to stay close to home. He's going to USC in California. So congratulations to both of them, but they are high school seniors, if you will, and you know you've seen Sam and Susanna behind the cameras, very faithful, and I appreciate your commitment to what we're trying to do. You're not the least bit embarrassed, are you? No, okay. But they work so hard behind the camera, being quiet and getting the great shots, making us all look 20 pounds thinner, and we appreciate that. But again, congratulations. Thank you for your hard work, and congratulations again. Thank you very much.
Mayor, Commissioners, I'm very pleased to offer a proclamation tonight, but I'm also, I have to be honest with you, I'm very disappointed as well. I think it'll become obvious when I read it as to why my disappointment lingers. But it is, in fact, a moment of great celebration because 4 years ago, you might remember my EA was named Megan Wright. Not all of you had the pleasure of meeting her, but I've always had these extraordinary Air Force spouses who have been my EAs. Megan was very insightful in predicting my mood, and also as well as filling my needs based on that mood interpretation. And she brought to me a candidate for her replacement as my EA. And she said, now, I know what you're going to say when you interview this candidate, but you need to really interview. I said, well, I'm looking at this resume. This kid's 18 years old. What do you really think that I just, Eric, you gotta meet this kid. So she brought in this parade of folks. Amongst them was Katie Dimbeck. But there was this young man who had come to us as an intern. His name was Jacob Foose. And as I looked at Jacob, and he was clearly very uncomfortable in his brand new suit, but he looked like he looked like the werewolf in London. His clothes were perfect, and he impressed me immediately. And I came out and I said, Megan, you know, you were right, but you know, I can't, an 18-year-old EA probably wouldn't work. She says, oh, I knew that, but you got to hire this kid, and we did. And Jacob has served us for the past 4 years in a range of capacities that I will extol here. But Jacob's leaving us, and he has been hired as the city manager in Burns Flat, Oklahoma. And that's an achievement in which we can all take rightful pride, because I think we all know that we contributed to his maturation and his opportunity to be selected. And Jacob, if you'll join me up here, I have a proclamation. Jacob Foose joined the city of Enid as an intern and immediately impressed the staff by his professionalism. You can stand by me, it's okay. He embraced a range of challenging positions, delivering unparalleled accomplishment no matter the circumstance. His enthusiasm was a source of positive emulation by all members of the city team. He displayed a maturity that defied his tender youth and strove at each opportunity to define new responsibilities wherein he may excel. He accepted and flawlessly performed as the Assistant Safety Director, the Acting Director of Communications and Public Relations, and as a Special Assistant to the City Manager. He redefined resourcefulness and ingenuity. He assumed tasks that typically elude those with similar work experience. He exhibited a dedication and a loyalty that inspired the best efforts of all within his view. He was selected to lead the very visible and demanding role of Parks and Recreation Department Director in a time of intense scrutiny and mission change, wherein he adroitly managed a dynamic series of logistical challenges, purchases, and change to revamp the quality of life for all of Enid. Indeed, his is a legacy of success, empowerment, and collective commitment to the common good. His selfless devotion to the task at hand, combined with the boundless energy and the finest can-do spirit, clearly define him as a one-of-a-kind asset. His consistent and empowering customer service ethic inspired all with whom he operated, managed, or mentored. Now, therefore, I, Bill Shuey, Mayor of the City of Enid, Oklahoma, do hereby proclaim May 20th, 2014 as Jacob Foosh Day.
Mr. Mayor, Commissioner, City Manager, as I always tell Mr. Benson, it's an honor and a pleasure to work for the City of Enid. I've learned a tremendous deal here, got to work with a number of wonderful people, and got to see what a tremendous impact we can have on the community by hard work and good teamwork. So thank you all.
Now, one question. I had to look. Burns Flat isn't...
been there.
Is it close enough that we can just annex it and keep you on?
There you are, buddy. I'm with you, man.
Is it a coup? I mean, if we just go there now, is it a coup instead of an annexation? We talked to Andrea about that. We can work something out.
I'm with you, Commissioner.
Yeah, sure. Yeah.
We got the vehicle.
Right. Good luck, Jacob.
Never been to Burns Flat?
No.
It's a suburb of Deal City.
That's D-I-L-L, yeah. Not D-E-L.
Well, Wikipedia says it has an official spaceport, so. Yes.
You could land the space shuttle there.
There you go.
747 can land there.
Well, they got a rocket scientist to run the place now.
Item 6, under hearings. Item 6.1, conduct a public hearing on the proposed 2014-2015 general fund, special funds, enterprise and debt service funds, Enid Public Transportation and Vast Development Authorities, and related budget documents for the City of Enid. Harold?
Yes, Mayor, Commissioners, this is simply an item to offer the public, it's a hearing to offer them a chance to give input to you as we try to finalize the budget. And the item has been advertised in accordance with the law 5 days in advance of this hearing, and it's also happening obviously 15 days before the new fiscal year starts. So with that, Mr. Mayor, if there's anybody here from the public that would like to give you input, this is the chance for them to do it.
We have one person signed up, and that is Julie Baird under item 6.1. Julie.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor and Commissioners. I'm Julie Baird, Executive Director of Leonardo's Children's Museum, 200 East Maple Avenue. And I always like to take this time during the hearing to publicly thank you for your continued support of Leonardo's as we enter our 20th year of operations. During the budget review each year, it seems like we spend a lot of time talking about funding given to Leonardo's each year and how it is to be used. And instead tonight, I would like to use my time listing some of the value that Leonardo's brings to the City of Enid. First and foremost, tourism. Marcy Jarrett, your ECVB chair, calls Leonardo's one of the tourism anchors in Enid. We average about 90,000 guests per year from throughout Oklahoma, an average of 40 states and 10 foreign countries. And we know, because we track that about 47% of them originate outside Garfield County. If 1 in 10 of those visitors has a meal in one of our restaurants or stays in one of our local hotels, and we know they do because they tell us, then that's an added benefit for the City of Enid. I was talking to Keller the other day, and he told me that they had about 110,000 this first year in the Enid Event Center. And we feel like we also provide ancillary support for organizations like the Event Center and David Allen Memorial Ballpark, giving those who visit Enid for concerts or baseball tournaments another reason to stay downtown. Leonardo's is also mentioned frequently as part of economic development. As businesses are recruiting individuals to live and work in Enid, we know Leonardo's is part of that recruitment tour. Not many cities our size even have a children's museum, and certainly not the world's largest community-built outdoor playground. Another factor in economic development is quality education. And we have great schools in Enid, and Leonardo's also provides educational support for the local schools and parents. 21st century learning, we hear about it all the time. It values the importance of preparing today's students for tomorrow's workforce by using the tools of creativity, communication, collaboration, and critical thinking. We see that happening daily at Leonardo's. Plus, we teach, in addition to running the museum, we teach an average of 1,100 art and science classes, both on-site and in the community, each year at local schools and daycares. Leonardo's also pays about $13,000 to $14,000 per year in sales tax, most of which comes back to the city of Enid. Last year, we paid almost $35,000 in utilities, and by our guess, about 30% of that went directly to the city of Enid for water and sanitation service. We employ about 24 employees per year, and last year, we paid $289,000 in salaries. Regardless of which economic indicator you use, those dollars turn over several times in our community, resulting in additional revenues for the city of Enid. I could list more, but obviously Leonardo's is as important to the city of Enid as your support is to us. But again, we do not ask you to do it all. Instead, we ask you to help us help others by making Leonardo's accessible to those who need it most but cannot afford to visit even once. Last year, Leonardo's leveraged your $25,000 in support into $85,012 given back to Enid. This included 4 free admission days, 142 family memberships, 46 summer camp scholarships, 126 free art and science classes, 87 other program scholarships, and Title I school group visits. According to our most recent audit, last year, 85% of all Leonardo's income went back into programs and services. That is not just donated dollars. That's 85 cents out of every single dollar that comes into our organization. The industry standard, according to Sarkis Foundation, is 70%. Ours was 85. We hope you will agree that that is a great return on your investment, and we sincerely thank you for entrusting us again this year. Thank you.
Thank you. Under item 8, administration, item 8.1, discuss and take necessary action on the fiscal year 2014-2015 City of Enid budget.
Skip 7.
Item 7.
We're none.
Community development. There are none. I'll not read that again, Gerald. You're up.
Okay. All right, Mayor and Commissioners, tonight we're going to talk about 9 different budgets. And these are the specific budgets we're trying to talk about tonight. And certainly it's an opportunity for you to talk about anything else that we've talked about over the last 3 nights. We'll run through a couple of slides and turn it over to Dan Onasor, who's going to talk about the budget for airport. We're progressing along, meeting our requirement budget. This is the third meeting that we have planned. We're planning to, if you guys are comfortable and budget captures your priorities, we're ready to come back on the third with what you tell us tonight and be ready for you to approve the budget. Specific topics tonight: airport, police, special projects, 911, fire, CDBG, EPTA. And golf. This just kind of, this is the same as what you have in that I just mentioned. I think with that, unless you have any questions to start off, I'm going to turn it over to Dan Onosorge, who will talk about the airport. The version that you have that I sent you last, actually the page numbers match up electronically with what paper copy that I gave you. So it should be on page 92. The airport, Dan.
Mr. Mayor, City Commissioners, Mr. City Manager, go through this real quick. As you know, the airport fund is an enterprise fund. We have to live on our revenues. Our revenues are generally brought in by our sales of fuel and our hangar rentals. And with that money, we pay for our personnel, our licenses, groundskeeping, maintenance, fuels that we use for our vehicles, insurance, et cetera, et cetera. Big project we have going on this year, obviously, is a runway extension. There's $4.3 million for that extension in here. We expect to bring in about $3.8 million in grants. Any questions on the airport budget?
Or fuel sales this year compared to years previous?
They're actually higher. Last year, we sold 392,000 gallons of jet fuel and about 50,000 of avgas. Avgas is about the same, but jet fuel is on track for 360,000 this year.
And once that runway is completed, what's the expected result in that?
It's hard to say. It probably will go up just a little bit, but time will tell on that.
Is that because you can land bigger planes?
You'd be able to land faster aircraft, not necessarily bigger aircraft. Faster. The weight limit will be the same as it is right now. Anything else?
Any other questions?
Looks like you deleted the recovering of hangar 17 and 22. Is that, are we just delaying that to another year? Does that really need to be done, or what's your thought?
We'll delay it to another year. We just don't have the money to do it right now.
Well, I appreciate your budget being 15% less than last year.
Thank you.
Thanks, Ono.
All right, the next budget up will be police. And that starts on page, actually, we'll start with special projects, which is on page 86.
Commissioners, Mr. Benson, we'll start with Fund 12. Actually, the police department has four different funds that we cover. These are all, again, enterprise funds. Special projects is pretty straightforward. Basically, that is state seized money, federal seized money, and some restitution funds. We never really know what the revenue is going to be. We're just making about the same as last year. We never really know what our expenditures are going to be because that fluctuates with whatever we get in. I will say that I think in revenues in Fund 12, we're expecting federal seizure money in excess of $100,000 sometime this year, in case that our narcotics guys. So it's just sort of a flexible fund, and it's used basically for support for narcotics and some of our other operation. So is there any questions on special projects? It's sort of a confusing fund, but we sort of narrowed it down to the seized money. It easier than restitution. No questions about that. If we could move to fund, we can go ahead and do Fund 51, police. I don't know what page that's on. Sure, Jerry does.
128.
Okay, and Fund 51, this is the biggest fund of the four. You can see that revenues this year are $200,300 less. The commission voted, lowered the revenues projected, and our expenditures basically are $9.5 million, with the revenues being 9.23. So it's about a bit of a deficit, but the deficit is not a damaged deficit. We have a healthy fund balance. You can see on the detail, our fund balance projected at the end of this year is about $4 million. After this budget, if we expanded every dollar, it would be about $3.8 million. Historically, we have come in the last 10 years that I'm aware of in under budget, which we'll do again this year. We're very fiscally responsible. And basically, our needs, some are growing this year. Some of our computer and software infrastructure needs are growing. We get a new program, they have their handout for software support, so you buy into that and then you pay for it. So that particular line is growing. Everything else is basically about the same. In capital outlay, we will be getting another dozen of the new SUV units. We will probably start ordering them. I think we can order the 2015s in July, so we'll start doing that right off the bat.
If I may, on your revenue here, you're predicting the revenue to be less than it was last year. Is this because the citizens are getting more law-abiding than they have been, or?
That's where we make more revenue in Fund 12, with the seizures. But it doesn't necessarily mean they're being more law-abiding. It just means that some of the revenues are down. I mean, the way your commission voted on how to do revenues this year, keeping them flat. And then some of the interest rates and interest funds that we used to get, but it's a very small deficit, which I guarantee I'll make up. And like I said, this year I've been well under budget, and I've been every year.
Ryan, do you budget new replacement vehicles every year?
We do, sir. Historically, we bought the used ones from Missouri, and now we branched out into the new vehicles, and we're going to buy a couple extra this year. I think we can get just as many years out of them as we could.
How are the eight or nine new ones working out?
Outstanding. I've not had one single complaint. We used them in the snow, all-wheel drive, six-cylinder. They move just as fast as an eight-cylinder, and they're a lot more functional.
Easier to get in and out of, aren't
you? Easier to get in and out of, for sure. And they're built actually for police work.
Do all of them have computer screens in them, consoles?
No, that's something that's coming in the future. We're looking at a tablet-based application for the cars.
I was getting ready to ask you about that. I know that's something that's been discussed in the past, is going having an iPad or a tablet-based system in there. Is that where are we at on that?
I actually have a test tablet right now that would work in a docking station and with a keyboard, with a mounted keyboard in the cars. Just recently, with the changeover the city did from Suddenlink to AT&T in their internet, we were able to move our dispatch screen, make it, I don't want to get technical because I can't, set up a domain, and I can access my dispatch screen and record system from my iPad, from my tablet, from my app. So we're moving that direction. If we can access that with citywide wireless, which I know we can, then we can move towards having that information in the cars. And we can do it cheaper with a tablet and a mounting station than we ever could do with a laptop, especially getting away from licensing.
And more space.
Yes, a lot more space.
We have dash cams in our police vehicles?
We do in our traffic units. We have 10 traffic units. They are all camera equipped.
Seen much benefit of those yet?
Yes, they always provide very useful evidence, sometimes comical evidence, but yes, they're very useful. And it's used in court. And every time the overheads turn on is when the camera and the recording starts. There's no discretion from the officers in there. As soon as the lights go on, camera's on.
Just make a compilation video to show at the Christmas party every year. just a thought.
There is some comedy involved. You know, unfortunate incident with people, there's always something. But yeah, every traffic unit does. And they're the most active on traffic stops and DUI enforcement, things like that.
So if the revenue increases this year instead of staying flat, if the actual revenue, the amount that passes through to you is, you know, a percentage, I don't remember exactly how the percentage breakdown is. So what do you do with the money that isn't on paper here, but you may receive? How do you handle that? Does that just will that get rolled into your fund balance or?
Yes, at the end of the year, usually if revenues are higher than what was actually paid, mm-hmm. what was budgeted, it would roll into my fund balance. In a lot of the years, in a lot of the past years, when revenues are coming a lot better, we get either a mid-year or an end-of-year adjustment. We get with Gerald, and we figure out how much is going to roll in on the last transfer of the year.
Sure.
Books are closed. Well, that is exactly how we built our fund balance and over the years to do everything that we've wanted to do over there. And the fund balance is very healthy right now.
What's the next big project?
Next big project, which eventually I probably will bring to the commission at some point in time, and I didn't put it in the budget because it's not quite ready by any means, and we'd probably ask for an appropriation at the time, could possibly be a facility at our range, which would be a live fire shoot house, which there is not one within numerous states in the world-class facility that we want to do. This would be possibly a public-private partnership. We've got some preliminary plans on it, and it would be run by a company. Of course, we would have a lease agreement and get a revenue stream off of it, for sure. They would do a lot of training with law enforcement from around the different states, and it would definitely put us on the map in the way of firearms training.
What was that called, Ryan?
It's be a live fire shoot house, is what I call it. It's basically a house that's built to use live weapons in. And you see it on TV a lot of times where they go in and they do hostage rescue and they actually shoot live rounds, and they have catwalks over the top where they film and train. Very high tech. It's an idea that was put forward, and I think it's doable. I think once we get into the meat of it, we can get revenue back from it. And I think it would be a great thing for us and for the other law enforcement agencies in the state, because there are none.
Sounds good.
There's nobody really have one. All of the ranges in the state are being encompassed by housing developments in the metro, and we're unique because that where our range is will never be built up. It's pretty straightforward. Any questions about police budget? All our needs are going to be taken care of, and it's definitely doable even with a slight deficit. We'll erase by the end of the year. There's no questions on police. We can go real quickly to 911. Don't know what paid. The 911 system is changing this year. This is now the Enid Garfield County Major County 911. We've added a revenue stream from Major County. We're taking Major County into our fold. We're taking their 911 revenue that they passed, and we will, as of about June 10th, we'll be going live taking the 911 calls for Major County. We can do that without a change in personnel. We can do it with our existing equipment. And basically what we get out of it is over $120,000, about $150,000 in revenue from Major County, which will add to our 911. So that's a pretty good deal for us. We don't expect a big, huge workload. It's all computerized. If somebody dials 911 in Major County, kicks over to us, we kick it right back to the sheriff's office, ambulance, fire department.
After it's decoded.
After it's mapped.
I sit on that board, and the collaboration between Major County and the 911 director, which was Singleton, and now is Wilson. They've done a great job of getting that, and it seems to be a great fit. I'm excited about the collaboration that we've had, and the additional income certainly helps that, because as many of you know, the funding for 911 systems is dropping because people are going with cell phones in lieu of landlines, and the 911 systems are receiving about a third of the income from that move. Meanwhile, being mandated to move to enhance 911, so you've got more expensive equipment, less funding. So they've done a great job of incorporating and solving that issue. So it's been a good collaboration.
You can see that with the revenues, even with the extra money from Major County, the revenues still are under our expenses. It does leave, I think we'll do better than that. A projected fund balance at the end of 101,000. I think we can do better than that.
Brian, are other counties looking at the same thing as Measure County?
We're sort of talking to Grant County.
Sort of?
They're sort of allied with Woods County, but I don't think they're very happy.
Yeah.
But, you know, it's a good way. There's a lot of 911 centers that have five or six counties. Obviously, they're a lot bigger than we are, but we can still expand. And we've been able to put in the micro data system this past year, which I think Lawton was going to do that, and I think we beat them to it. So we're definitely at the cutting edge on the equipment in the 911 center. So if we can get another county, I'll take them. So it's very little work for a good return.
As long as we don't have to do their dispatch too, and that's a catch. That's the issue, I think, with Grant.
They want to tag it along with it. And any other questions on that? Last but not least, we have Fund 52, which is page 134. Fund 52 is the CIC, which is Community Intervention Center, which is a juvenile holding facility that we have inside of our building. It's used for holding juveniles until parents or guardians can be found and then released back to them after they're cited for whatever infraction that they're arrested for. It just alleviates the need for the police officer to basically babysit an underage offender. This is mainly funded in revenue by grants. The grant has been flat for about the past 3 or 4 years with the state making cuts that they did. The grant's about $170,900. We don't know an exact figure this year, but they said expect it to be the same. So they haven't got the final number, but we expect it to be the same. It's also subsidized by Fund 51. We give $75,000, and the city gives from Fund 10, I believe, gives $40,000 to assist with the juvenile offender program, because we also run that. And revenues, we have lowered the revenues on that in years past by staff down by one. So, and we're able to run it with the staff that we have now. And we don't look to expand. I think we're one of the busiest CICs in the state. We get a lot of kids from, well, we have the campus police, we have our own police, we have the county, and Wacomas, everybody else. And if they do bring somebody in, we're in theory get a little revenue from them for a few dollars. It's not much, but it's a good service to provide.
Is this staff 24 hours a day, 7 days a week?
It is, most like everything that we have. And a lot of times on some weekends or on holidays, we'll staff it with one person, say a female or a male employee. And if whatever we get in, if we get a female offender in, then we're good. If we get a male, then we have to call the male back in. And so we have somebody on call, which is a reduced rate. And if we call them back, then we have to call them back. So we work it like that a lot of times for cost savings. But their fund balance will be fairly healthy. It's numbers that we have to work with, a $300,000 total budget. They're very low maintenance. Questions on CIC or any of the others that we talked about that come to mind?
I have a question about the 911. With cell phones being what they are, how are they chipping into the revenues for 911? I can't imagine somebody on a telephone with an emergency being able to handle that like a 911 operator. You have to educate me on that.
Well, as landlines as opposed to cell phones on revenue?
Like just working, being successful.
A lot of it's magic, technical magic, on how they do this. When they can triangulate a cell phone and map it, and it shows up on a map exactly where that cell phone is when they call, as opposed to a landline, which you know what house it's in. Now, revenue-wise, the issue with that is about $1.25 or $1.50 a month per landline is sent to the 911 or sent to the county 911. And with cell phones, VoIP, like cell phones, any kind of wireless phones is about 50 cents. So we're losing 75 cents off of every time somebody drops a landline. And so far, the state legislature has not helped us out too much to move wireless fees for 911 up to at least a dollar. Would be a great move. Now, so far, they're studying it for the last couple of years that I'm aware of. So I don't know how long they'll study it, but you know, most everybody, myself included, I don't have a landline anymore, so I'm not giving $1.50 to 911. 50 cents for my wireless phone. Now, Major County, I think that's a big landline community. Farm, a lot of rural, and they generate a lot of revenue off that. A lot more revenue off their landlines than what they do off their wireless. So hopefully the legislature will address that at some point in time.
Thank you.
I've got some ideas.
I have talked to Mike already. Any questions? Thank you all.
Thank you, Brian.
Mayor Shuey, Mr. Benson, commissioners, I believe the fire budget begins on page 135. I can start at the beginning.
140.
Okay. Change my budget too.
It's a 135 of mine too, Joe.
Okay, well, I feel okay about it, I guess. First, I'd like to talk about staffing at the fire department for next year. I am adding one civilian employee. It's going to be a fire protection support water tech. That position is going to be an individual who will be exercising the valves on the water distribution system throughout the city of Enid. He will also address problem areas or issues with the water distribution system that we know we should have better fire flow, but we need to get somebody out there, be under the direction of the fire department, so when we find the problem, we should have an immediate response to the problem, and hopefully we can take care of some issues that we know are out there and improve our fire flows for the community. At the bottom of the page, revenue total, and it shows that for next year that my revenues will be down 5%. I do want to draw your attention to the grant heading where there's a decrease of $240,000, and that's the biggest part of that 5% decrease. And in reality, the $240,000 that was budgeted last year, we did not get that money, so we operated without that $240,000 last year.
What was the reason for that not being received?
Actually, I believe that was an encumbrance from the year before, and we just it takes them a while to award the grants, so we kept it in the next year's budget. And over the last couple of years, our priorities at the fire department haven't been the priorities of AFG. In reality, last year I budgeted probably $150,000 worth of equipment that I'd been asking for on grants for 2 years. Pretty well said, we don't have the priority that they're looking at. It's time to buy it. Now, this year we probably won't write a grant. We do have some needs either next year or the year after for personal protective equipment, PPE, bunk outs. We've been successful before with that grant, and I think we can be successful again. And we will be writing grants, but like I said last year, we pretty well budgeted what we needed in the special equipment, and y'all approved it, and we bought it. I guess it would be page 141. I thought I'd go over just the general headings. You can look at under personnel services. We show an increase of 6%, 4% in regular pay. That's due to the collective bargaining agreement, pay raises and merits. Also in the collective bargaining agreement, we had an addition of 2 paid holidays that was in their contract, and that's why the holiday pay went up 15%. Another big increase in personnel services, of course, is health insurance transfer, which is $134,000 of that increase. Under contractual services, we show a budget of 46% less. Again, the majority of that reason for that reduction is the grant expense that was before under the heading of contractual services that we don't have in the budget. Under maintenance and operations, we're pretty well holding our own with a 2% less budgeted number. And when we get down to capital outlay, not near as much money for capital outlay is budgeted this year, mainly flip over to the detail page under capital outlay. We'll see that I've got a command staff pickup, not command staff, a command staff pickup budgeted for $30,000. I'm doing some refurbishing of Station 1. It's it was built or constructed in 1984, and I've got some areas that are pretty wore down. We did the front lobby and the public areas this year. We're almost completed. I'd like to continue that throughout the station, ceilings and flooring. Also have a parking lot in the back that's in terrible condition. It's a large parking lot. It's used for training purposes as well as parking for events, and that expense is going to run me about $85,000. Concrete's one of the least favorite thing I can think of to spend money on, but it seems like I've been doing a lot of concrete replacement over the last couple of years, and it's not cheap. Also, you'll notice that under my capital improvements, there's no fire station. But, I'll be back later in the year. I think we'll go out for construction bids in middle of August. I'll get that bid, and I'll come and ask you to appropriate me the funds to build the new station. Also on there, you'll see that we do have some items that are outside the contract, and there were some reasonings why not everything was in the contract. Some of it I could see was a lot cheaper to do outside the contract. Some of this work is moving existing equipment that's at our existing Station 4 and moving it to the new site. So we'll hire a contractor, City of Enid, rent equipment to move the generator, radio tower, some of our communication equipment. But that total comes up to about $90,000. And that also includes the furnishings in the station, appliances. There's quite the list that's outside the contract of the actual construction of the new fire station. But like I said, I did it intentionally. There's some areas I think the City of Indy could save some money on. That's why I did it that way. Overall, if you looked at my total budget figure, I think it's $16,000 over last year's budget figure. And I guess I'm open for questions for any part of my budget.
Joe, I'm sorry, did you address when you expect to start construction on?
Bids go out, I think, on August. I think the construction bids go out on August 10th, and they have like 30 to 40 days to respond with their bids. And then soon after that, I would assume that we'd start breaking ground.
To open when?
I think the
springish
ideal date, maybe like March 15th, 2015.
Is it March?
Yeah. Anything else?
Thank you, Joe.
All right, Mayor and Commissioners, I'll direct you to page 145, and we'll talk about the CDBG budget. The Community Development Block Grant budget is a budget that is received through the federal government. This budget does not cost the city any money, per se. Grant comes in, and we do our best to spend it following the guidelines of the Housing and Urban Housing and Urban Development Department. If you look at the budget at the very top under grant revenue, you'll see grant revenue's down slightly for about 4%. And that is just something that we're probably is going to be a fact of life with budgets at the federal level, probably tightening up and decreasing. I think Stephanie's talked to you about that before. Commissioner Tim, I think you're on the CDBG committee.
Yes, sir.
So you probably have been briefed on a lot of that.
Is that a concrete number now, that $999?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. If you'll turn your attention to the personnel section, you will see that there is an increase on personnel there, and I'll explain that. This department over the years has operated with one full-time person and at different times one part-time person. This current year, and I think maybe the year before, we operated with one one full-time person, which was Stephanie, which CDBG guidelines allow for. But they also allow for that half person for further administration. And also on Stephanie, I know we did not replace the grant resource manager when she left. So we have asked Stephanie to do more than just CDBG. So therefore, we thought that it was appropriate under CDBG guidelines to add this part-time person to help her keep up with the CDBG stuff and out there actively searching for other grants to that we can utilize for projects that are important to you, like trails, EPTA, et cetera. So that's why there is an increase there. But if you look in the contractual services part, there's a 7% decrease. Bottom on maintenance and operations, there is an increase. It looks like a rather large increase, 37%, but you're talking about small dollars. You're talking about a $1,000 increase to buy some additional computer equipment to bring her area up to date. Overall, that whole budget is still a 4% decrease in expenditure. Oh, and on the slide, I just wanted to bring your attention to, you've already approved this at a previous meeting, but this is the current year allocation. $507,000. The total budget is $999,000 because it includes the new allocation plus the previous grant money to finish expending the previous grant money, which is broken down into what you allocated last year, and then those additional things you see here, personnel and the few things that are in contractual and operations.
How much longer do we have on the Section 108, the repayment loan?
2018, I believe, or 2019 is the final payoff.
Got several things rolling off in 18.
It's actually, I can flip over to debt book and just tell you definitively.
You're going to be on the commission.
Pays off August 1st of 2019. That's on page 150. And that is a rather good deal. The interest rate, well, I don't recall exactly what it is now. It's about 2.something%. It's pretty low. We refinanced that in 2010. And again, the city does not have to pay. That comes off the top. For as any of you know, heard it. It comes off the top before any money is divvied up and allocated, as you see here.
It'd be nice to have that additional money. Will they, pending further cuts, you know, that's money that would possibly still come to the city and be divvied out rather than going to?
Yes. Absolutely. Assuming that this budget will still be, you know, this size, that would just be extra money that could then be used to help the city and give out to other projects. Any other questions about CDBG? Okay, we'll go ahead and move to the next one, which is Public Transportation Authority, which is on page 186. I think several of you are very familiar with the Enid Public Transportation Authority, too. I think Commissioner Stubbs-Zell serve on the committee. In fact, you may have already been briefed on this budget today or yesterday. Is that? Did you? A meeting? Maybe not. Okay. Well, you're going to get briefed on it right now. So, as you look at the personnel under James Neal, who was the general manager, has been reorganized into what you see with 8 full-time positions and 9 part-time positions. Overall, with this reorganization in this year, there is a slight increase there on personnel of about 6%. But there's a decrease in all the operational areas, and overall, there's a 5% decrease. When you look on page 186, the operations revenue that's coming in, you'll notice that one of the grant programs has disappeared entirely, which was the Road to Work program. We were budgeted to receive $26,050 this year. That program has gone away. The grants down below that we get through the Oklahoma Department of Transportation have slightly increased, which is positive because they had been decreasing for a while. And the amount that's funded from the city has stayed the same. However, overall, there is a deficit, as you know, and this budget has been extensively worked on trying to find the best mix of expenditures, best use of those limited dollars to accomplish the goals of EPTA. And I know James Neal is here, and also the current Director April Thomas is here as well if you have any specific questions for EPTA.
I would just like to take the opportunity to commend James and April on the remarkable turnaround that we've seen in this department. I think we were bleeding to the rate of what, $600,000 per year. I think it was a lot, and to see that I know it took a lot of change, you know, and not everybody likes that, but I think the definitely moving in the right direction. So thank you guys.
And we'll also, we're going the right direction. Ridership's increasing, access is increasing, we are operating more efficiently, we are driving fewer big fuel-intensive vehicles, more minivans, more people are getting access. I'm thrilled. I know this is a hard one, but you folks have done a really good job with a really tough operation. I'm thrilled. Thank you.
Thank you. What is our average wait time now?
Could you say your question again, please?
What is our average wait time of our clients to get us to show up?
They schedule with a 1 hour advance notice at least, and we give them a 30-minute pickup window. We had taken that 30-minute pickup window to about a 90% accuracy rate, which meant that we picked them up within that 30-minute window 97% of the time.
And it's an on-demand, so you call.
They call in, and you tell them when the vehicle will be there within a 30-minute time frame.
They call in, and they schedule a time for pickup, and we will tell them that it will arrive between the time that they have scheduled within 30 minutes of that time. So if they schedule a 1 p.m., it will be there between 1 and 1:30 p.m.
In other words, if they've got an appointment, they better call. They better set it up early.
Yes, sir. And that was one of the major cruxes of the ability to cut our costs and increase efficiency was pushing it towards pre-scheduling those rides so that we could match our assets to the demand for the day.
What about the people that have a regularly scheduled ride? Don't you probably have some people that have a set time pickup every day?
We do. We have some that are put in permanently, and so they've already set it with that 13.
We were sending the big buses around with an average of, you know, one seat filled, one person on there, and that, yeah. What, 8 or 9 miles at the gallon with those things, it just was not
good. It hasn't worked since the 50s.
And you'll note there's significant reductions in fuel and vehicle expenses in that budget, probably as a result of that.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
Good job. Gerald, do you know what the 2012-13 expenses were for that fund?
Projection is, Aaron, can you look that up for me? Yes, we will look it up and we'll tell you in just a moment. While we're looking that up, is there any other questions on EPTA? Wanted to know total expenses, Commissioner, projected
for the year. 12-13 should be in last year's budget book. Just
are we all small vehicles now, or we still got some big ones?
We still have quite a few large vehicles. We were able to purchase during this fiscal year outright one minivan, and we were able to achieve grant funding for more minivans. Those four are still inbound, and of the three we have at the beginning of the fiscal year, two aged out. They became prohibitively expensive. So right now we're down to two vans. We'll get that up to six. But there are times when, due to the load and the number of people we're carrying at peak times, where it is more efficient to run the vehicle. And what we've been trying to do is make the perfect match of the assets to the demand so that we're running the large vehicles when that's more efficient, and then we get them off the road and put the small vehicles out there.
I think the 2012-13 expenses was at $969,385 is what it was in the budget book last year.
$900,000.
Yeah, almost $970,000. Yes, is that correct, Gerald?
The actual expenditures, though, turned out to be about $754,000,
okay.
Because that's when we began serious look, restructuring that, James, change. Does that answer your question, Commissioner?
Well, it does, and I'm going to do what I do. I'm going to ask a question that maybe does. I mean, we're sitting here saying we've cut $600,000 out of this, but I'm asking the question, show me. What I see is $754,000 expenses in 13, $738,000 in 14, $697,000 in 15, a grand total over 2 years of an $80,000 savings, not $600,000. Am I missing something here?
Well, you might remember last year when first time we looked at the budget, they came in with a $300,000 deficit. If we had run it exactly like we had run it in previous years, it would have needed a much larger transfer. And Commissioner, you and the commissioners said, you know, we got to do better than this. And James came back with a, I can't remember now what he cut it to.
And I think, just to clarify, sir, I think there's a difference between the budget as was originally proposed and what you're looking at as the budget that was approved. The budget as originally...
I'm not looking at the budget at all. I'm looking at expenses. And the cash that was spent in 12 and 13 was $754,000 on that department. And I'm not questioning what you did. Clearly, it's a completely different department. But I'm trying to figure out where we saved $600,000 on paper in front of me.
I guess it's probably a deferred cost. Years previous to that, we had to feed this fund pretty healthily.
Well, it should show up in the expense number.
In those two budget years is when James has had the opportunity to make that turnaround. The 3 years prior to that, we fed that fund by almost $600,000.
Can you back up two more years and give me the expense number, please? You don't have to do it right this minute. We can move on. But I don't see those.
Was
760,000. And then it went down slightly to 754, then it went down to 738, which
was 946,000.
So while it might not have been 600,000 exactly, it was a significant, approximately $300,000 there, going down 900 something to 647.
$247,000.
I think where I was getting that number was the deficit and with the with the proposed budget, and I think that's the point. We said we can't do that. And I knew there was a $600,000 number in there, but
I welcome. I think it's a great opportunity to check our stance on strategically how we want to fund an operation like this. Clearly, it's heavily dependent upon grants for equipment, but it's also a yawning hole. And if you look at the ridership, rider per cost, dollar per rider cost, it's not insignificant. However, the side of that is that those folks who ride it probably don't have another opportunity. It's up to you to balance that. I think it's a great idea and great time to have this discussion.
We're helping a lot of people who need the help. And I also hope that as time goes on, I imagine that we're still adjusting to this big change. It was a sea change. It was an absolute change. And I hope that we continue to see ridership increase, that we continue to see efficiency increase. But this wasn't, you know, a 1 month to totally change operations. This is a multi-year effort to turn what was an incredibly inefficient system into a more efficient system that can still help the people who really, truly need it.
That's all feel good. I'm looking at data.
Well, sometimes we do feel good.
James, what else could you do in the future that would lower your expenses? I guess that's where we'd have to start.
Moving forward, I think the biggest thing is getting those smaller vehicles in and moving to a leaner mix on the small vehicles. I know April has some other ideas.
Yeah, also looking to the future, possibly CNG, converting some of the newer vehicles, possibly one of the shuttle buses still mileage, converting that, we'll still need the shuttle buses in the future.
Are you seeing more on the other side? Are you seeing more people using it now?
In the past month, our ridership has come up. It's hard to tell at this point. People are still adjusting all of the change that took place over this past winter, and that can take a while. But we hope to rebound, and we expect our ridership to go up.
It's pretty common across the industry. Anytime you make changes in a transit system, people that use transit are typically very set in a schedule and a routine and a method of operations. And when you make changes, your ridership goes down. We made a lot of changes in a very short period of time.
It's probably hard to get changes actually to them that have changed. I mean,
and getting them to realize them as positive changes is merely a matter of getting them to experience it. It's not something you can market into their head. It's something that has to be experienced. And so
do you think that this thing's going to right the next 2 years here?
I do, yes, sir. Looking at the cost differential, I would add that we cut the budget from what was proposed to what was approved by nearly a quarter last year. So going from that to this year, there's not nearly as much fat to trim. So there's a lot less room to cut back in this budget preparation than there was in last year's budget preparation.
We've also made some changes this year. We're at the point where we can start making those smaller changes that cumulatively will have a big impact. I mean, one change being in the past we've had, so if you are wheelchair bound and going to a doctor's appointment, you may have a personal assistant, or what's the
PCA.
PCA, personal care assistant. Coming with you. In the past, we had let those folks basically ride for free. At this point, we've said, look, either drive your own, if the PCA can, of course, pay the fare and ride along, or if they want to help you get on and then drive their own car over to where you are and help you get off, that's fine too. But we're at the point where we have a functional system that we can start looking at the little things. In addition, we have been increasing the way we do advertising, changing things up, just trying to get people to understand how the system works. I think not only is it going to become more efficient, we are just helping more people. And sometimes we do something that costs money because it's good for people. It's just what we do sometimes.
It is good for people, and if I could, I would add the money that the city puts in, putting in $120,000 a year, is far outweighed to the order of about four times in the revenue that comes back into the community because of that investment, direct investment. And you can figure more than two-thirds of the people we carry are going to shopping and to work. They are turning upwards of $1 million a year in indirect economic activity in the community. So added together, about $1.4 million in direct and indirect economic activity in the city. Because of the city's investment in public transportation.
And there's all kind of ways that you can examine this issue, and I'm not espousing one point or other, but if it comes to a matter of saving dollars, we can only do marginal savings on a budget like this. The question is whether or not you want to provide this service. And if you want to save money, if that's the issue, and there are other priorities, that's the decision you have to make. That is the only way that you will carve this money out of the budget. We can reduce it, we can make it more efficient, and you're only going to have marginal changes in the budget requirements. And I certainly don't suggest that can't be offset by the generosity that a society provides to those less able, even though they can be pretty hard to stomach sometimes.
So can we all sometimes.
I can. Around here.
Yeah.
I think the need is only going to grow in the future for public transportation.
It would be beneficial to see a full year under the new guidelines and under the savings they've put into place. Next year, I think it will be very crucial as to whether it is something you want to support or something that you'll have to look at.
Let them do their job. Keep working at it.
Thank you, sir.
All right, that brings us to the last budget that we have planned to talk about tonight, which is golf. It's on page 98, but we realize that we're not completely happy with this budget, so we've done some additional work and passed out a handout, which you should have. So we'll work from that separate handout that you have. And one of the things I want you to note is that on budgeted positions, you can see that there's 7 permanent full-time positions. There's 3 part-time positions and 3 seasonal positions that really are required to run the golf course at the level that it's at today. If you look at the revenue side, Commissioner Van Hooser, you pointed out the revenue side, really we're not anticipating any increase in there. The increase that comes from that is coming from transfers. And I want to say that on the handout that I gave you, when we revised this, it became apparent to me, not at the time that we finished this, but that transfer is not as bad as it looks right now. We should be able to reduce that based on the change in personnel. There was management has already made the decision to take. There was one full-time crew worker, and that position's been converted to a part-time position. So that has resulted in some savings of approximately, approximately $2,000, a $2,200 decrease from last year's personnel budget, which will allow us to reduce that transfer to about $252,000 instead of $300,000, which is about a 15% increase. Why do we have to do that? I'll tell you why. Because unlike EPTA and some other funds that we have, this fund does not have fund balance much left. So that is why that is something that we felt was necessary to put in there. When you look at the expenditure side, as I just mentioned, personnel expenses are down 1% in this budget. Everything's down 15%. Contractual services are down 15%. That's because of an effort that was made last year to change out the cart fleet, go to Yamaha, which was a little bit less expensive, and still the quality was still good. We did have to pay out club car last year, but we've realized some savings of about $18,000. We'll continue to realize that for the next 2 or 3 years. So that was a big decrease. When you look at the maintenance and operations portion overall, that's also a 1% decrease, and you can see the various areas. And the expense category finally is 3% down. So I know that the way that we present golf too, maybe that's something we need to consider looking at. We show golf as a standalone fund, a fund that we think can generate enough revenues, or have thought that could generate enough revenues. The truth really is, over time, golf cannot generate enough revenues. It's dependent on some factors that can't be controlled, such as the weather. And I think on the sheet that we've also passed out, a page sheet to you, that's got some facts and statistics. Cody Lacks here, Adelaide Golf Pro tonight too. He's compiled this to really show you some of the challenges that he has had. So he's tried to provide a great golf service for those that are taking that, which is another one of those things. All those things that Cole was showing you earlier, this is one of those things. I don't know if it was exactly on that list, probably because we already have it. But to have it at this level, you have to make a decision to fund it. So really, as you look at some of the challenges that he has, his primary competitors doesn't run in Turkey Creek, quite frankly. Meadow Lake at the bottom's at $3,650 for a round of golf. Pheasant Run's at $3,683. Turkey Creek is at $30, but you have to drive to Turkey Creek. So that's one of the challenges. Cody has put in place a 5-year business plan. Last year he raised green fees. This year he potentially could look to raise green fees again, but the challenge you can see right there is if he raises the green fees to where he's higher than the competition, I don't see how that's going to help the revenue situation, because that's going to drive people away to other golf courses. So really this is not exactly I'd like to show you a rosier picture, but this is what it is. Run the golf course if that's what you want to do.
There's an unfair comparison when you place golf in an enterprise fund, because frankly it's required by state law because it generates the amount of money that it does. Golf course is a park. If you were to examine the other parks, say Meadow Lake or any of the others across them, they are funded in the same manner that we fund golf course in with these shortage transfers. They also make money. They just don't make as much, so we don't have to account for it. So a side-by-side comparison shows that, it's a quality of life issue, and it's a park. But the way we have to identify it for to conform to state law, it places a scrutiny on the golf course that our other parks don't have to bear. And given the same comparison, golf would at least be paying part of its way.
Questions on golf? That is that's the end of the budgets that I want to present tonight, and we're kind of at the point now that we've covered all the budgets in the city in some detail. Is there anything else you would like to see, or are there items that you are concerned about, or that
you Yes, Gerald, there's several things, a couple of questions, actually. I got to looking through the budget book, and a couple of questions occurred to me. One of them is on the comp plan rewrite that we have budgeted for $400,000.
Yes.
We discussed that earlier. We were told that it might be $300,000, but we thought we could get a better deal than that. I was wondering why we budgeted that at $400,000.
Well, that was kind of a... You were also told it could cost as much as $500,000, and that would be dependent on what you wanted and what detail you wanted. What we came around to with what we felt like the budget could support was the $400,000, which included not only the comp plan, but the traffic study and the zoning regulations updates. So really, you're accomplishing three things.
Yeah, but we're basically just updating an existing plan. I would have serious problems with spending $400,000 on this project.
This is your budget.
This is a 5-year deal. I mean, every 5 years we got to do this, and to spend that amount of money on it every 5 years for a plan, that bothers me. Along that same line, under Public Works, the payroll, we showed overtime in Public Works for the coming year would increase by 238%, and the health insurance cost would increase by 114%. Anything like that in any of the other budgets?
Was that let me get to the right page here. That sounds like that's on page.
I don't have space.
61. You're talking about? Did you say 238%?
Yeah.
Yes, Commissioner. That is a lot of overtime. Keep in mind, this one department was significantly reorganized. Folks,
61.
Other departments into this department. Specifically, plumber apprentice, metal fabricator, welder, electrician.
Why would that affect overtime?
I think what we did when we looked at this budget, we rolled up what we thought was accountable to those folks and those budgets, and we added them all up, and it ended up being a $9,500 increase, which came out to 238%. I will tell you that the city manager for about the last 2 months has strongly discouraged overtime. He's asked supervisors to work within the resources they have within a 40-hour work week and only use overtime when needed. That's just a number we can...
It's an awfully big number.
Right? Certainly look at that and with the city manager's direction and look to decrease that. It's really not that big a number. I mean, the percentage is huge, but
you're talking about $10,000.
Jim, did you want to say anything about
it? Well, these are grouped in this category for a reason, because they're key skills that don't translate across functions. A welder, plumber, an electrician, these technical services folks that are called out frequently on jobs that nobody else can do, and their core requirements. And a $9,500 increase in the department, it reflects the fact that we move folks into there from other departments and strengthen this core capability. Though those increases would be captured in other departments with larger numbers, and you wouldn't even notice them, but because we changed the number of personnel, it skews those numbers for $9,500.
If I saw 238%, I'd notice it in any department, actually.
Well, I agree, and it was a conscious decision of mine to reorganize that department.
Well, you're right. It's not a large amount of money.
About a fifth of an employee.
One other item that I brought up last year, and it was discussed, and I'm going to bring it back again this year, is our contracts with some of our consultants. I requested earlier in this process that we be provided with justification for continuing their contracts, continuing to fund their contracts, and I've received nothing on Kurt Rogo, and I would like to make a motion that we not fund his contract for the coming year.
If Member Service Commissioner, you ask to see more from them and get regular updates from them.
Well, since I brought this up last year, I haven't really heard anything that he's doing for us that we don't have, isn't done for us by our elected representatives.
He brought those elected representatives to our community twice to meet with you and four times to meet with the other.
They should come meet with us anyway. I haven't been shown anything that he's done for us this year or the year before. The OML gives a lot more information about what's going on in the state capitol and what bills are pending than he does.
They give us information on bills that are pending, but they don't give us influence and identification on the actual votes that affect Enid. OML works for the whole state.
What did Kurt do this session? I mean, session ends Friday. What did Kurt do for us this session?
Kurt kept our the identity of our water needs primary. The influence of Enid in that effort has really been lacking in recent years. There was legislation that would have gone against us had we not had an advocate there to present our side of that. There's very little municipal presence in the elected body. It's almost absent.
I mean, our water needs, we all know what our water needs are. We're not going to get any state money for helping with the water needs.
No, but you will get state legislation on how you retrieve it and how you use it and how much you get to take out of it. And that's prime consideration for a community like us, who's wholly dependent on water.
Commissioner, if you look at the state water study that the state did, I mean, they all but ignored Northwest Oklahoma. And Kurt has been very... very active in bringing that to them and saying, there are areas up here.
Now, the counter argument is we've been paying Kurt for several years and they still ignore Northwest Oklahoma. I mean, we've got access to Patrick and Mike without Kurt.
And I would suggest that those same elected officials were willing to vote against their home community were it not for our identifying the impact of their decisions. In one case, they did.
A little hard to predict, but yeah.
It's hard to play the game unless you know the rules. And as you well know, that game is one of influence, insight, and the preparation of materials for those people before they vote. You're going to learn this if you're elected to that position. And if we continue our old way of being isolated here on the prairie without a presence in the state capitol, we're going to suffer as we have. We've slowly clawed back into a prominent position for identity and on with issues of water. It's seen at OWRB, it's seen at ODEQ, and that identity that Enid lacks is now working in our favor. I submit that we're one of the few municipalities that would have that capability if we eliminate this one.
He's the one that, to me, looks him face to face and tells him what.
He might be worth something, but he's not worth $48,000 a year. Not in my estimation.
If he's not there, the money that's there will not come.
I don't believe that. I just, like I say, I haven't seen it during my time on this body, and I, like I say, I would make a motion that we not fund his contract. If it doesn't get a second or approval, that's fine, but I don't think we're getting our money's worth.
I'll second.
Well, motion, we have a second by Ron, a second by Ben. Further discussion?
Motion was made to not fund Kurt Rogo's contract in his proposed budget.
To not fund it?
Yes.
How long is his current contract?
We can only do a year at a time. I mean, that's
all. He had, I think he had a two-year contract, but I know that he has a non-appropriation clause in his contract. So the commission's fine.
Would the intent of your motion, Commissioner, be to honor this contract and not fund it afterwards, or to immediately cease funding it? And what
would the impact be? Not to fund it for the coming year.
2014-15 budget.
So how would that affect the contract, Andrea?
The contract has non-appropriation clause. It allows the city to terminate the contract at the end of any fiscal year should the money not be appropriated for the next fiscal year. So his contract would still run through June 30th. It would then be terminated, and he wouldn't work for the city beginning then July 1st. With no penalties. There are no penalties in his contract.
I think we have a lot, in my way of thinking, we have a lot more to lose. It's what, in the long run. It's hard to put a number on that. Any other discussion? Please cast your vote. Motion is defeated, 4-2.
A couple other questions, Mike.
Just one issue. It was brought to my attention that I know in the local program funding that Youth and Family Services, I guess, did not put in a request this year, and from what brought to my attention that was inadvertently done, and I don't know if that's a requirement or if they want to revisit. It was $7,000 that they requested last year, and I believe received last year. So I don't know if anybody has an interest in seeing that funded. I know that they do provide quite a service for, you know, those that need that. For $7,000 is not a lot of.
Are you aware that they have a $2.2 million plus budget there?
I have seen their budget, yes. And I know it's another one where they get grants and things like that as well.
I agree with you. It's not a lot of money, but not a lot of money adds up to a whole lot of money. And they've been submitting for several years now, and they knew what the requirements were. They failed to comply with the mandate that you all set forth in previous budget years. If you want to fund them, go right ahead. But they are a strong entity in and of their own funding, and I personally don't see it compared to the rest of our budget as being a requirement.
My only concern would be that it could be a scenario where support from the city, even token support from the city, gets them points for other competitive grants. I don't have any clue if that would be the case with them. I could certainly.
I can't answer that.
Yeah, that's one of those who.
I'll find out. That's all I've got right now.
Good point. I have a question.
Yes, Mayor.
What do you project our rainy day fund to be at the end of this year, and what was it last year?
Well, talking about the fund balance of the general fund, we'll flip over to page 10. I project to be about, with this budget at the end of this coming year, well, you asked at the end of June, projecting $7.3 million. And with the balanced general fund budget, I would project that it would be the same at the end of 15 budget year.
June 30, 2015, $7,304,000.
Good. Yes.
Remember what it was last year?
I believe it was slightly higher. Aaron, can you look up that number for me?
Is that, didn't we draw the money for the park upgrades from the rain day?
Yeah, I did.
I've got it here, Daryl, if I can find it. Sit. $5,391,000. It's $2 million difference.
That was cash versus the total fund balance. A total fund balance would have been 7-point-something million as well. Last year. Okay. So actually it's up a little bit. We estimated it would be, what did it actually end at, though? We'll look that up.
It was projected, well, in June of 2013, it was $8,100,000. Next year, it was $5,391,000, and I think that was that money for the Park and Recreation. Does that mean we...
You're looking at a prior year budget document?
I'm looking, I think, at the same report a year ago as what I'm looking at today.
What page are you on, Mayor?
10. I'm looking at the summary estimated revenues and expenses for 2013-2014.
Okay, so you're looking at last year's budget document. What did it show? It showed at the beginning of the year, it showed, you said, $8
million? Correct. $8,137,000.
And showed 5.6?
5.4.
Okay, well, we ended better than that.
That budget also was prepared before we took the $2 million. That was the projected fund balance. Mm-hmm. We took $2 million right out of that.
Yeah, I'm not sure which iteration of that. I mean, you know, the budget.
I think that version has to be before we decided we made that decision.
I think
that's going to add up to the $7 million balance that's there now.
At the end of this coming a year from now, I think it's out of there because our rainy day fund was more than $5,391,000.
We actually did $8.1 million.
June 13 balance sheet.
Yes.
$8.1 million. So we are down from that because we used some of that. Approximately about $800,000, it looks like, because we're down to 7.3 is the projection now.
For
the end of this year.
And this is only a budget. That's not the actual.
Right. That's just a budgeted number.
Okay.
That was the actual number.
I think that's healthy.
Yes.
And I don't recall what was proposed for this year in our parks department. Were there any capital outlays for equipment or
capital expenditure?
Anything?
There was $300,000 in the budget specifically for ADA improvements at the parks that we've already improved. $750,000 of playground. There's also approximately $55,000 in there for the Ferris wheel.
Ferris wheel, the basis.
For capital projects, that was what was in there. Yeah, $350,000 based on the machine that we're purchasing this year that's gone out, I believe, shortly, that you will see at the last meeting in June to approve. Roughly the estimate on that's $450,000. So that machine will allow us to lay the concrete using city labor and achieve a lot of savings, we hope. So so that $350,000 should go a lot further than it really sounds. And I know that engineering's working on exactly how far.
Sure. I know that there's some projects, particularly at Meadow Lake Park, that there's two rides that are in storage right now, the small kiddie rides, and there's a lack of concession stand. And I think, did I hear the number of the bid on that building, or the estimate on that building was, you know, less than $200,000? Does that sound about right?
At what point it went out?
Sure.
I mean, that building's designed. It would be not difficult if the money was there to get that out for bid and to pick that up. I'm with you, Mike. I think that'd be a good.
I think an addition of a dog park at Meadow Lake, I think, would be a great addition. We've got, you know, one at Crossland, but I think having one at Meadow Lake would certainly benefit the city. I would propose that we pull $500,000 from the rainy day fund, and not to exceed that amount, but to fund that building and the fencing for a dog park at Meadow Lake.
Tell me about the building again, Mike.
Well, the design, from what I understand, will have
for the airplanes and the cars.
Yes,
and the concession stand all in one.
And a restroom. At some point, this building had some restroom. At this point, the restroom at Meadow Lake, and considering the amount we put into that area. The restroom is it's a small creepy prison.
Well,
And if a restroom could be incorporated, and I believe at one point it was, into this third building.
It's also been brought to my attention that every time that door opens, anybody in that parking lot can see everybody in those stalls.
I'd second your motion.
Well, and I would just add, too, that potentially maybe some funds in capital, there are funds in capital improvement, too, that could do that or something else that you desire, too, because that $900,000 we talked about, the additional trail money that's going to be transferred to capital improvement, but all of it's probably not going to be spent this year. We know we'll be able to execute about $450,000 for that machine.
Does anybody have opposed using those funds towards Meadow Lake and not messing with the...
Either way.
I'm sorry, I didn't hear.
Well, I'm concerned a little about what we're doing to trails here, in a sense. I mean, last year we decided we were going to spend $2 million on trails. We didn't spend half of it. Now we're spending another million of it on non-trail-related projects. We've added nothing in capital fund for 2014-15 that has anything to do with trails. And as we know, they're at least a year behind on planning and development in terms of getting any concrete on the ground. So we can build a boathouse and we can put some sidewalks down Broadway, but what we're saying is that trails just went from a priority to a nothing for at least the next 24 months because there'll be no money to do anything for trails at all going forward. I think it's a mistake to pilfer that fund. We're going to have a $450,000 machine, no budget to lay any concrete anywhere.
Yeah.
That may create savings, but we're not planning forward for what we're going to do with that. I'm a little concerned the direction we're taking here. Mm. It's easy to spend this money because it's laying around, but we already spent it. We just don't have it on the ground yet.
Yeah, I agree with you, David, although I would take one objection. I think the Broadway money is trails. It's just trails in a different form. It will be connected, and I've talked to lots and lots of people since we talked about this last week who are thrilled and enthused about that prospect. So let's call it trail, but I think you're right. I think the plans that the staff put together for either around Crossland or that link from Crossland down to Cleveland, if we had that other $450,000 in money there, then maybe we can get some more concrete on Broadway or we could start picking away at the Crossland Park deal. I think that I frankly would still like to second Mike's first motion and pull down that $500,000 for Meadow Lake and leave the money that we said we're going to spend on trails. The machine counts. There's no argument there.
It'll cut costs.
And it will, but $450,000 worth of concrete could be a lot of concrete.
What you're proposing is adding, and I agree with you. I'll take exactly what you said and I'll agree with it. That means we need to add $1 million into this budget to compensate for what you just took away from the trails.
I didn't follow that part. I'm sorry.
Because we're spending the million that we haven't spent on other things. So if we still want to, you just said we want to still spend that money on trails down the road. Well, we need to put it in the budget. So we got to come up with $1 million.
Okay, maybe I don't follow you because it sounds like we've got $900,000. Half of that can buy a machine. Half of that can buy a lot of concrete. And then we're spending money on trails this year between Broadway and whatever concrete we can get down somewhere else. Then we're spending almost $1 million on trails this year. Now, part of it came from last year, but we're still spending money on trails, and it's getting on the ground this year. And Eric promised us that someday we're going to get downtown, come hell or high water, and having some money in the budget of that $450,000 that could be used should some incredible thing change and one of these properties comes in the market, then there's some money there that we can go snatch it up. So I don't think we need to find another $1 million. I think we need to pull $500,000 from the rainy day, as per Mike's suggestion, and keep that rest of that $450,000 for either concrete or one of these little houses or in furtherance of trails, so we have a little bit of flexibility to that end.
I don't think we're still on the same page.
Yeah, maybe I don't understand.
Because we're spending last year's budgeted funds. I mean, we may do it in this calendar 12 months coming up. What are we going to be putting on the ground in 15-16 that we're starting now? Because we have no additional money going forward. What you're saying is right. We're going to, the numbers all add up, but we're spending last budget's money, not 14-15.
Sure.
So where's our future thinking? Where are we going to be 2 years from now when Eric's not here anymore?
Yeah.
Push us. Where are we going to be?
Maybe what
we're not putting any money in the budget for that. We've got zero essentially for new projects and trails.
Well, maybe what that is, what we need to keep in mind is we're just going to be doing trails differently from here on out because we're going to have this machine. And
Where's the budget to lay it down with a new machine? I mean, that's my point. What are we going to do with it?
Here's my question, and maybe the question is, we don't know exactly how far $350,000 is going to get us in sidewalks. Is that correct, Chris? We've got some idea.
That is true. In particular, on Broadway, we have the ADA ramps that we have to deal with,
sure,
and the approaches coming up to Broadway.
Yeah, and then we really don't know how much it would get us if we were doing it in the middle of a park either. We just haven't used the machine. Maybe you're right that there's not going to be another $1 million in this year's budget because it's not there today, but I think we're going to see a sales tax increase of 5%, and in 6 months we're going to have more money to spend, and I'm going to remember we had this conversation, and I remember we had it last year
and we didn't make it.
Well, we got pretty close, but in 6 months I hope that we're spending more money on trails, and maybe that's where it comes from, David. I think also in 6 months we're going to have a better idea of our capabilities with this new equipment. We'll have used it, I hope.
There's a little bit of design work that has to be done ahead.
Yeah.
Do we have people that are trained and able to operate this machine?
We will. Well, that comes with purchase, the training. And
how many people does it take to operate?
I think that, well, there's one driver, but then you got to have a guy that pours the concrete, and you got to have the guys that shape the sides. About four is a pretty handy number.
Now, we've been trying to hire additional concrete folks this year, didn't we? Did we get those jobs
very
hired?
Difficult. Well, we hire some, then we lose some. It's a very difficult one to fill. It's hard. It's backbreaking labor, and it doesn't pay tremendous amounts. And the guys that we have that do it extremely well.
Sure. The Finnish guys, I mean, that's a skilled deal.
We've been unable to hire the ones that we want, the numbers that we want to hire.
So, David, do you have a alternate suggestion?
Well, one, we don't divert the money we decided we were going to spend on trails to something else. We can agree this year to pull another $1 million out of the rainy day fund towards the project for, I mean, we don't have money, Ben, to buy the land, I don't think, the houses that we need to buy for that last piece that you're, you know, passionate about, and I'm all for if we can do it. Where's the money going to come from to do that? Because we just spent it all. So that's what I'm saying. I'm not really picking on what we've done this year. There's no future in this. And I think we're going to be sitting here in 2015-16 going, God, we should have done where was the money? So I don't know that I have a straight up answer for it.
It is a hard problem.
Sort of dipping into the rainy day fund again like we did last year. We made that decision. I think it was a good one. We're going to have a mile of trails to do it. But
the game plan is changing in the trails area because we're about to run out of city owned property. And it's going to be very difficult to start buying property.
Well, we just saw a proposal last week, Mr. Mayor, to put one around Crossland Park that's already on property that could be a done deal before. So that's not the go downtown part. We got to acquire property for, but we own a lot of city right of way that we can put trails on that's in the master plan that's not going to require buying more property to accomplish that.
And I don't want to further complicate this, but Gerald, there's a figure that aligns with grant money that has to be spent in pre-approved location. And that, in this case, it's across the park. $160,000
has already been applied for specifically for Crossland Park. Now, we don't know if we've gotten it yet, but if we do get it, we'll need additional money appropriated at that time.
$160,000
Crossland Park.
Yeah, it's a use or lose, but you have to use it at Crossland Park.
Okay. So
what did we apply for it to do? Usually you have to list something.
We applied for trail around Crossland Park.
And is that is that an even match?
Oh, it's just $160,000. I don't know what the split is. Do we have that?
What period, Gerald?
20.
In what period?
Next year.
Next year if we get it.
So at that point, if we use that, of that 900, we use half to buy a machine, half to set aside for buying concrete and putting it in place at, obviously, with, you know, we can't, I'd like to be there to be some flexibility with the staff and with the engineers to work out details, to figure out what works well, to figure out the efficiency of the machine. So I'm reluctant to throw down a hard dollar figure on Crossland Park. With this grant funding, that would change the calculus too.
$160,000 buys a lot of concrete.
Sure.
If we're the ones putting it down.
Yeah. Now, I will say the other option we have, David, of course, is if this going downtown route progresses, and if our agent, who better be out there trying to get these properties bought, comes to us with a couple deals, we can appropriate. I mean, if the deal comes in the middle of the year, because we don't exactly know when it will happen, and either we'll have money from sales tax or we'll have to dip into the rainy day fund, I hope the former, but the latter is always an option. At that point, Eric can bring the deal to the table and say, look, if you appropriate $250,000, we can buy house X, Y, and Z and get and start checking those boxes. We can do that then, right?
You can. You can make a budget amendment. And I have some encouraging movement at that score of the property acquisition, too.
Good.
Well, I can tell you that we have a master trail plan that covers the whole city. When engineering and I looked at it, the reason we picked the Crossland down to Cleveland was it was the majority of our own property and properties mm-hmm. that were that should prove to be a little easier to obtain of all the areas that we could have picked. Also, when Cleveland gets widened and Boulevard, there will be
a 10-foot trail on the east side.
10-foot trail on that as well. So when it connects into it, I mean, it made sense from the standpoint of getting as much concrete on the ground as possible.
Sure.
What was the number on that?
350.
Crossland 350?
Yeah.
It was the 350. Mm-hmm. Can you subtract $180,000 from that?
60.
You're at $170,000.
Well, the money's there if we just...
The 350, though, currently you've directed that we would spend on Broadway. So, we would need another 350 appropriated either later or set aside.
I'll amend my motion to make that 850, 350 to encompass the trail around Crossland and down, you know, to connect, and then, you know, up to 500.
I'm fine seconding that.
And the money for Meadow Lake would be specifically applied for two buildings?
No, okay. One building and...
And then the dog park.
The dog park you're intending is to the east of the water tower.
No, actually, no. I've got another area that I would like to look at, but I think we can...
There are options.
You know, have some actual that. Real shade in there would be really nice.
Yeah.
You know.
I'm going to ask you to repeat that motion.
That we appropriate $850,000 out of our fund balance, our rainy day fund, to do the Crossland project, trail project, and Meadow Lake Park, the for the rides and the dog park. And it may not even take that much. I don't know. I think that's too much. But I'd rather...
And the building has... Sorry, go ahead. Building has restroom. I mean, the building we're talking about is the building with concession stand, two little rides, and restrooms. Some
yes.
meaningful building there to finish out that plaza.
I think Matt called several of us, but it seemed like it was under $200,000.
Yes, I like I said.
So we're going to be.
I'm estimating on the high side.
Basically,
I will add that the concession stand is definitely you can make the change, but what we had kind of talked about in the park board meeting was moving it from a man. Operated concession stand to a room that has several
vending machines
that could be open all the time,
yeah.
as opposed to something that you actually have to operate.
And you know, a soda machine, a snack machine, an ice cream machine, they have, you know, those are right. cheap and easy to operate and
cheap.
It's all relative.
We have a motion by Mike, a second by Ben. Any further discussion? Please cast your vote. Motion carries 5-1.
One additional question, Jerry, on the main page, which is 10 in the new book that you gave us today. If I understand where we started three or four meetings and multiple hours back, shouldn't the budgeted revenue number for 2014-15 equal the budgeted expenses number for 14-15?
No, because there's individual budgets that aren't balanced. We've talked about some of those tonight, like golf.
At the end of the day, we were going to do a revenue neutral budget.
We did do a revenue neutral budget, but we still have expenditures that exceed that revenue based upon last year's or this year's estimated amount. The primary areas are EMA, which is about a $3.2 million deficit, which EMA funds most of the capital projects that we've talked about. Police and fire talk tonight to have small deficits. APT and golf have small deficits. EEDA has a small deficit, relatively, I guess, $600,000, $700,000. General fund is balanced. Actually, it probably won't be balanced now with what we've got. So that will add to that as well. But we're able to do that, Commissioner, because of the previous surpluses that have been accumulated in the fund balances in those respective funds. That's the only thing that allows us to do that.
Balances in prospective funds to a layman is a savings account. A balanced budget doesn't dip into the savings account, other than what we said tonight, that we're going to take out of the rainy day fund or the excess fund to do this $850,000. Other than that $850,000, it ought to be even.
We're going to have some work tonight.
We need to do some work. So that was the original direction, was that that needed to be budget neutral based on last year's revenue is what we're budgeting to spend for next year, if I understood it correctly. So if that's what we have to do, then bring back another budget. There's going to have to be some cuts somewhere, because we can't pilfer this thing up another 3 or 4%.
We're trying to use guidance from the commission on where do you want us to take that. We can make our best, but we sometimes miss.
I guess you're going to have to point out to us where we went over and where we need to make those hard decisions, because I'm not clear after.
I think Gerald can give us a thumbnail sketch of those numbers tonight. We've left over with this very same issue, and I agree with you.
I think the biggest area we probably should turn to is EMA, which is on page. Page 160, specifically, give us a good idea of the big areas that we're looking at trying to trim.
60?
Yes, page 160 is the detail for EMA. Specifically, look at the bottom right on 160, you see that 4710 transfers to other funds. You will see the general fund receives money, a street and alley receives money. EEDA, capital improvement, street improvement, sanitary sewer, storm and stormwater. So, and water, looking at the upper right on page 161, you see it continues. Water capital improvements, $2.9 million for a total of $3.2 million in transfers.
Now, Gerald, which ones of those must we pay?
Stormwater is one that by ordinance we have agreed to move the stormwater fee from the utility that fund to deal with future stormwater capital needs. Same way with sanitary sewer. So it's a really capital improvement, street improvement, street and alley, and general fund, as well as water capital improvement are areas we could look at. Remember, Chris went over the capital projects the last meeting we had on Tuesday, a week ago. Look at some of those projects. That would be a place to look to maybe trim EMA. We've already, you'll remember, budgeting EMA at 90% on personnel for 100% of the people. So we can't really afford cuts in that area, because we're already facing health insurance increases and such. Police and fire, certainly we could look at. I think golf and TA we could look at. You've heard some of the difficulties about those funds tonight as well. So it is a challenging problem.
We might need to look at Chris's projects again.
Okay. Gerald, you've done a really good job of putting this budget together. I think the projects we've planned on doing are important. There is money there to pay for them. I'm really reluctant to cut out more than we have, and I know that was the direction that we gave you when we started this budget season, was to go back and cut out, and you did, and you cut out a lot. I frankly am just reluctant to go try to find further cuts, and I don't know if that feeling is shared by anyone else sitting up here, but we've got a good budget, we've gone through everything, and I'm just reluctant to see more.
What I thought the direction that we gave him was that we didn't want to make a budget that was planning on revenue that we weren't sure we were going to get.
Yeah.
I didn't realize that it had to be absolutely balanced without taking into consideration the funds that we were carrying over from the previous year.
Well, we have the minutes from that meeting in front of us, so I guess we could look and see what the motion actually was.
We're talking about $6 million or so.
Well, but it's transfers, so it's not actual $6 million. Is that correct, Gerald?
No, it's $6 million.
Okay.
So moving from one fund to the other. Sure. That's just one big area that we could look at. There's other things, Commissioner, you talked about one. You guys make the decision on what kind of comp plan you want for the city. I mean, you guys individually can make decisions on any of these areas. I would say, personnel-wise, like I said, I just want to remind you that in the general fund, we've already taken a 10% reduction, so we're funding at a 90% level. And so that is a concern going forward, that there's no extra money there.
I mean, this is the hard decisions. This is what we were elected to do. This is where the big boys come to the table, and we don't spend or plan to spend more money than we think we're going to get in revenue. And so, I mean, this is where the rubber meets the road. This is where we have to say, okay, we're just not going to be able to do that, gentlemen.
Well, but...
And we're not... And just to say, let's just blow it off. It's a good budget. Let's just ignore it, and we'll deal with it at the end of the year. That's not responsible. And I don't want to sit here and I'm not going to go along with a budget that has a planned expenditure in excess of 2013-14's revenue. I can tell you I'm going to vote no right now.
Did you... Gerald, did you go back? Was your understanding what our direction from that meeting was, to go back and assume a flat revenue change?
That was exactly our guidance.
Exactly. Yes. Right.
And that's what we've applied.
And is that what we're looking at?
No. We went back and looked at a flat revenue, and the flat revenue is captured in here. But if we're talking about flat expenditures...
That's not what we asked you to do. We asked you to budget for a flat revenue.
Well,
let's read the motion here, because
maybe
my
what you
memory
heard,
of the
but that's not the fiscally responsible
okay,
thing
but,
we said. We
but,
said we'd spend what we made, and that. And now you're trying to. I mean, this is not Gerald's fault. We've done it. We've sat right here $100,000 at a time and made this budget go over, guys. It's our fault. It's not. I'm not blaming Gerald. I'm just asked a question. The expenses exceed the revenue. What does that mean? Well, we're over, guys, and that's not what we sat here and said 3 weeks ago.
Well, if what we said here is, Gerald, make a budget that is an absolute flat revenue projection, then that's what he did, and that's what we're looking at. And so if you want to come back and say at the end of this budget process, well, that thing we asked you to do and you did, now let's cut more out, then maybe that's one thing. But you cannot go back and say Gerald didn't do exactly what we told him to, unless I'm misreading or misremembering what the motion was, and I apologize, I haven't been able to find it quick enough, but my memory and my recollection, and based on what Gerald gave us, was that the motion and the direction was flat revenue, not flat expenses. And in some cases, those will be different.
Well, the guidance that I directed the staff to provide you was we would match our expenses in a balanced budget with what we had in revenue for the previous year. Now, we've done everything. We have done those hard things that we can do. We have reduced our overtime costs. We reduced our health care and our personnel costs by 10%. What remains are your discretionary decisions. And Dr. Van Hooser is exactly right. You did this by $100,000 slices. You can decide to stop doing things, or you can decide to go over budget. And that's your decision. Staff will execute what you determine to do. But our guidance, for 3 weeks, we've been trying to close the gap. We went from $8.5 million to $3.5 million. But the gap still exists.
Well, that, I guess that'd be the question I'd ask you, Ben, so that we can get on the same page. What's your understanding of where we are tonight? If we're done, do we have expenditures in excess of what the flat revenue number would be? I mean, is that your impression or not? Am I missing the?
Well, what Gerald is telling me, and what I'm understanding, is that I'm pulling that page back up.
So I think you just said, Eric, that in your rough math, we're $3.5 million off.
Agree with that number, Gerald?
We're really, if you look at the bottom line, we're about $6 million off. It's $3.5 million in EMA. You're right.
Yeah, I guess if you include EMA, yeah, it does get bigger.
Now, I will say that these fund balances that have been accumulated over the past, I mean, they are available to spend within reason. And certainly a balanced budget would be what I would love to see, too. The difficulty is all the needs that we have. And
some cases, they've accumulated the dollars for the future spend, such as fire and police. I think
that's right.
Police has intentionally gone into their fund balance because
they were saving up.
They have been saving up to do that.
I'm not in favor of touching their budgets. I think they do as good a job in those two departments as anybody.
So their fund balance expenditures we can pull from that $6 million. Because they
were only 2 or 3% off either one of their budgets to start with, and they have more than adequate, and they're funded separately in a sense because they have the quarter cent sales that's specifically theirs, and they manage it well, and they need to plan for the future.
They have
just like we do. We can't spend our future. That's, I guess that's what I'm saying. The city's fund balance at the end of the day can't keep going down every year, especially in what I think is going to be a neutral economy over the next couple of years.
What do you want to do? I mean, what are
we're going to have to go back and look at some of these, and we're going to have to take $100,000 at a time until we get to that number that makes this balance. It can't be personnel. It can't be health care. It can't be.
So it can't be personnel, health care. We care about parks. We care about streets. We care about roads. We can't touch sewer. We can't touch stormwater. At some point, David, we just have to.
You can cut those. It's your budget.
We have to.
You can do that.
So we're not being paid. Understand that what we can do and what we realistically should be doing.
The question is, how much do you want to accept a deficit budget, or do you want to balance it? We've done everything we can. Now it's up to you to make those decisions. We're part of this solution. We'll help you prioritize those capital budgets and all the other funds that we've identified here. Are streets important? Are trails important? Sanitary sewer? You bet.
Are we going to try and solve this tonight, or can we set a meeting to?
We've been kicking this can each meeting, Commissioner. In our mind, in staff's mind, this is the big elephant.
Okay. Well, and the motion, I finally found it. The motion came from Mike. Motion was made by Commissioner Stuber to budget a revenue neutral budget. Motion was seconded by Commissioner Van Hooser, and the vote passed.
Well, to me, that guidance meant don't spend any more than you make. Revenue neutral to us was interpreted as you can only spend what you brought in this year, and that budget has been,
I know there's three of us on this side of the table right here that heard it exactly like that. I mean, why would you budget half of the problem?
I agree with you, but I think if you look at these individually, your general fund here is the same. The next one, special projects. Chief already told us.
What are you looking at?
I'm looking at the funder.
Page 10.
Revenue and expense page 10. Special projects, he already said that they don't know what they'll have, so they budget to spend it all because it's there for that purpose. So it's higher than its revenue. I mean, if you go down individually, the one that is the only one that's going to stand out is $3 million in EMA. The rest of them have been saved for that purpose, like fire, police. I mean, fire is $500,000 larger, and police is a couple hundred thousand.
Well, let me just throw a big old steamer in the punch bowl here, but. If I were police and fire, I'd be thrilled to death because I am way overfunded for my needs. And we have an extraordinarily good police and fire department. But because we fund them so robustly, they have dedicated streams. Now, we also give them a pass every year and say we're not taking any money from them. So that pushes all of the decisions back on the general fund. That's why it gets so hard. All of your expenses are focused on one fund. And then, we make that up with transfers from EMA. And I'm not suggesting that we take from those funds. That's perhaps how we ought to fund all of our business. But the problem is, we got to do too much. We are core issues, and as a vibrant community, we need to address those needs. And quality of life ranks right up there. Bottom line is, if you want a balanced budget, you got to help us with some decisions that will create that. Am I going to get pistol whipped, Chief?
That was pretty interesting.
Well, I think staff has done a great job of trimming what they can, and we just have to accept that sometimes the city has to spend money. I don't know
happens in the year, though, you don't have the money. You just think it's going to be there.
Well,
what if it's not?
Rodney, this isn't like this is set.
You can't look back. and look forward. What happens if that money's not there?
And it will go bust someday, but this also isn't set in stone, Rodney. We have staff, we have Gerald that spend every day looking at how we're spending money. We have Eric trying to cut costs constantly. We have regular sales tax revenue updates. We know what money is coming in. We know when things change, and we adjust accordingly. But you made... What do you want to cut? We have things we just need to do. We need to be repairing streets. I'm not going to go take police and fire. We need to be doing these quality of life investments while the money is good, while it is doing well. Our economy is great. We need to be investing in our community, and sometimes that means budgeting this way. But if the economy goes in the tank in 3 months, Gerald's going to come back and tell us we have to change. What you're doing isn't going to work. But I don't think the economy is going to tank in 3 months, and I have a lot of faith in our city staff's ability to handle our money well. We can go on arguing this all night long, and we could start cutting things, but I'm going to make a motion that we take the budget that we have worked with tonight and stick with it and rely on our very capable staff to handle changes and hiccups as they come along.
And I would ask for a faithful support when we come to you and say we can't get there from here.
Absolutely.
No second. All right.
Worth a shot.
When I run the rough numbers here, it looks like we're 3.5% off. Right, $169 million budget, and then we're off by six.
It's back by 6 million.
Depending on which category. So what if we said let's take a run at, either exclude or include the fire department and the police department. But what if we just went across everything except personnel, healthcare, and the people, and said everything's got to go 3.5%, including our pet projects, including streets and roads, whatever. We want to take 3.5% off of every one of the capital projects, IT's budget, whatever it is. That would get us balanced.
Why exclude police and fire?
Well, I mean,
fair is fair.
Let's talk about that, but that would make it fair just to go on across the board. Would that be a reasonable suggestion on a way to make this balance and go forward?
We've cut our personnel budget by about 7%. You have a great job, both of you, but both exceeded your overtime each year, too. I mean, all of us, you get a free ride every year, Chief. You know that. You know you do.
This year's budget, we cut our personnel costs because we know we're not going to be full. We can't get full. So we have already made a huge cut to get to that 200%.
Absolutely. Both chiefs have done a tremendous job of managing their budgets. I certainly would extol that from here on. The issue is you're funded better than the general fund is.
The idea behind the enterprise funds was to save up the money for capital improvement.
Absolutely right.
Build the fund, buy your needs.
You're just completely different.
And all that's quite true. It comes back to a real hard decision. How do you, if you want to close the budget gap, what's on and what's off the table, and what you leave on has to be savagely attacked. 3% doesn't sound like much, but when you take away $12 million off the top of that, and you safeguard that, and then you safeguard other issues, pretty soon you're down to how many potholes you can fix.
I think we have to do it. I mean, that hard decision needs to be made. I think we need to make a stab at it tonight. We just can't keep saying it's going to happen.
Everything below the general fund, does not count in this. So all the departments, all the funds below, or is that the way you?
Well, I think we need the rest of the commissioner's direction on whether we leave fire and police in or out. But as far as I'm concerned, every single entity, like I said, other than the personnel that we have, is game for a 3.5% cut, and I think that would get us the $6 million we need. And if we include police and fire, it makes a little bit less on the other funds.
How do we handle contract costs? So, I mean, we can't cut Kurt OML and Mike Cooper's contracts 3%. Do we exempt those? Wastewater treatment facility, all those. I mean, and at that point, do we really care enough about $30,000 to the Oklahoma Municipal League and $48,000 to Kurt Rogo? Those are really more important than our core functions of street repair?
I don't think they'll add up to.
I think the way we'd handle that is like you said, let's just trust the staff. If every department knows they've got to cut 3.5%, let them decide.
How about we?
In the contracts or wherever it is, then they can work it out, because I don't know those details.
Is there a middle ground where we can challenge him to cut 2%? Let's meet somewhere in the middle.
To me, this is, well, we're in the middle at 3.5%, if you ask me. I mean, that's neutral. That's what I would do in a private business corp meeting. We wouldn't have this discussion in a private business corp meeting because we don't have taxpayer funds that we can just throw around. So we're in a different game here. But if I'm playing the same game here that I'm playing in any other business meeting I'd go to, we're not going to have this discussion. It's neutral to start with.
I agree with you, Commissioner. I really do. I just know that some of these funds have been gaining that money for the future needs. And so therefore the intent is to transfer it into years like this to when they can accomplish them. Capital improvement is another one of them. It's one of them that is, I don't know, a $300,000 deficit from revenue. But they have been gaining those because they didn't get to the project last year when the money was put in there.
Well, they don't eat into their fund. They cut 3.5% out of the expense side. And their fund balance at the end of the year is still going to be there.
But I'm saying the money was put there for that purpose. It didn't get used. And so next year when it comes along, that's where it should come back from.
So she's saying, as an example, the fire station. They've been saving up to do this fire station. And when they go to spend that money on a fire station, we're saying don't spend that money because it's not budgeted.
Money's still there. How are we impacting that? If he's got $1.4 million in his projected fund balance right now to build that fire station, it's still going to be there. He just can't spend he's got to spend 3.5% less on his day-to-day operational expenses, which he can figure out at his discretion, to make the overall budget end up at where we want it to be, which is zero. We're going to fill 3.5% less potholes. We're going to spend 3.5% less on buying books for the library. We're going to spend 3.5% less on our $25,000 commitment to Leonardo's. Every single one of those things comes a little bit off the table to make it fair to everybody so we can end up neutral. At the end of the year, if Ben's projection's correct and we're 3 or 4 or 5% over that,
sure,
then let's divvy it back out at 3.5. We can be fair about it. We just need to be neutral.
One of the things I'm concerned about in this process is that we're talking about cutting $6 million, and we're also contemplating spending $6 million to build a downtown parking garage.
That's going to be borrowed revenue from a different fund. I don't see that as in the mix, but maybe I'm not seeing your...
Well, it's $6 million we ain't got.
Well, but it's...
We're planning on spending
it. It's an asset. It's not just being spent. It's building an asset.
There's also... That's not $6 million out of our pocket. You've got New Market tax credits. You've got...
That ship has sailed, too, by the way.
Yeah. Well, it's like a lot of ships.
Well, and it's not money that's just being poured down. We are building an asset which will be on the city's books as an asset. It will also have a revenue stream. I mean, it's a little hard to.
You think it's going to make money for us?
God, I hope so someday. But I mean, it still is going to be an asset for the city for our use.
Not in my life.
But it will still be an asset in the way that we use it. I mean, it's.
So I don't understand why we took that vote of the day. I knew when I left here it sounded too good to be true, and here we are fighting it, and we voted to balance it. The runoff with the revenue from last year, that's what we voted on.
Well, to be fair, I think that's what he brought us, but clearly we don't agree on that point. What you really wanted to vote on was not a revenue neutral, but an expense neutral, which is something different. That's not what we voted on. We voted on revenue neutral, and that's what he's bringing us. Now, we can change our minds now, as we're all apparently going to do, but what you really wanted was expense neutral.
What would a revenue neutral budget look like then, Ben? Because
that's what we're looking at.
The revenue number is defined on June 30th because sales tax revenue dollars will be in the books or on the books, and we'll know what that number is. How except for the expense number to match that number, can it be a revenue neutral budget? I mean, how can it not be?
Because budgeting,
the only way it comes out zero is
budgeting for an organization this size isn't that simple. This isn't simple math we're talking about here. I wish it was, but
this is a small corporation in the world of.
Well, I mean, Gerald can tell us how he interpreted it. For me, I would interpret it as want to keep revenues the same level they were in this current year.
That was the whole discussion.
That would have ended it right there. Revenue needs to stay there. Our expenses, we cut and cut and cut to come under that revenue, and when we got to the point that we cut as much as we could, we utilized fund balance.
That motion meant absolutely nothing if we have free rein to make the expense side of the equation whatever we want it to be.
If you look at the budgeted revenue for the police and the fire department, there is $750,000 there because they have used some of their monies that they have set aside, and the expenses that they're going to spend this year are coming out of that rainy day fund that they have. The police department to the tune of about $250,000, and the fire department to the tune of about $500,000. You look at the budget expenses, their expenses are higher because they're grabbing that money that they have put aside to make those expenses this year. And their revenue is probably not out of line with what it was last year.
And they're budgeted appropriately, Mr. Mayor, to do their mission. The privilege that they have is that they can predict their revenue securely.
I understand.
What we do each year is jack with the numbers to make your job harder. And that, God bless them, they're saved that, and I wish I were in their shoes. But every year we do this to ourselves, and it comes down to the EMA and the general fund. We ought to budget the same way. We try to get too much out of that. I will offer this. If you'll give us another meeting, if not later this week, then early next week, let us come back with some hard choices for you. And we'll scrub these numbers, we'll scrub these options, and we'll further delve into it, but it's going to take your commitment. And when we present it to you, then it's your budget. You get to, if you want to spend more than you make, then tell us. If you want to balance it, we'll do that. We'll give you the options, but you're going to have to make the call.
I would propose that personally, I don't want to take from the police and fire budgets. I think that they've done a good job, and I know that they're working on some other expenditures.
Right. You're not going to bounce your back on their backs anyway. Hmm. It's not going to come. They don't have enough money to give you to solve the problem. It's our checkbook. It's the core services that we want to commit to.
Gerald, can you explain something to me? I'm not understanding something. Maybe that's part of the problem. I'm sitting here looking at page 10 of our budget, which has projected fund balance as of June 30, 2014. And then it has projected fund balance as of June 30, 2015, right?
Right, 6 million.
Assuming everything that we've done except for this $850,000 we talked about tonight, okay? Right. Our projected fund balances – this is where the money comes from, the projected fund balance end of this year – end of next year. The
yes.
Change goes from one to another. So our general fund, we're not pulling down except for this, let's ignore the 854. We're not dropping that down, right? Projected fund balance.
That's correct. It was
okay.
It was balanced. It's going to be unbalanced by about 850,000 now.
So, but again, let's forget that for the moment. So EMA is dropping. There's $3 million, right?
Right.
But EMA, we don't have $72 million in the bank on EMA.
That's correct. That includes investments in infrastructure throughout the city.
Right.
This will give you a headache.
It's like equity.
Give you a headache.
But that's
what I'm trying to get at.
That's a big chunk of money, Ben.
It is. No, it absolutely it is. What I'm trying to wrap my head around is I understand that we're spending more money than we're taking in. And there are instances in which the money we're spending is money we have saved up, and there are instances in which the money we're spending is not money we've saved up, but still money that's there. Can we break that extra expenditure into those two classes? Okay? Is that correct?
Can we break the 6 million? Yes, that's essentially.
So it's either money we've saved up or money we haven't saved up.
Essentially, it's surpluses from previous years, but those surpluses include assets that you talked about earlier. They include the residual assets, equity, the net equity.
Sure.
So when you're talking about fire and police, specifically a governmental fund that doesn't hold assets, fixed assets, then you're looking at that money that's really all money sitting aside, cash.
Mm-hmm. But there are some costs
for them to do things with.
And the cost that David is really concerned about, those expenditures, I assume, aren't what gives David heartburn. And you tell me if I say something wrong here. The expenditures that you are concerned about are where it's not we're spending savings that we've saved up. It's that we're spending money that you don't think is there. Is that correct? If Joe saves up $3 million to build a fire station and then builds the fire station, that expenditure doesn't give you heartburn, even though he didn't get $3 million in a given year over and above what he had, right? Okay.
I think I'm partially in agreement with you, because the number that's given me the heartburn is about $3 million, because I did exactly what you did, and if you pull the they're spending their fund to do projects they planned on doing out of it, then it's really not $6 million.
Sure.
It's $3
million. Right. Okay.
So I'm on the same page with you there. That $3 million gives me heartburn. If you can figure out how to solve that, I'll be on your team.
I'm just trying to understand it. I'm not even close to a solution here. I'm just trying to wrap my head around it. Okay, so where's that money, Gerald? Where's the big chunks? Is it really just a little bit here and there and here and there and here and there? Or where's the big stuff coming?
Are you specifically talking about EMA? EMA is where there are funds. There's also large numbers of assets.
Yes.
How much
so is that the $3 million that David is concerned about?
I think maybe that is. Is it the EMA budget that you want balanced? If that's the direction you give us, then we go forth and...
Because these other funds... They may be balanced one year or not balanced another year, but it's their money being spent. They save it up and spend it. We don't need to mess with that. What we're really concerned about...
That's generally correct, yes.
Okay, got it. So what we're really concerned about isn't six, it's three, and it's three from EMA.
There's really two overall funds you probably should be worried about. That's the general fund and EMA.
Okay, but general fund's balanced.
It was, yes.
Okay,
well, and now with the fund balance... That
we'll be okay.
Sure, but
EMA
let's, you
is
know,
about 3.2. You know,
we're consciously drawing down that 850 from the rainy day fund to make a long-term investment in infrastructure and the quality of life in the city of Enid. So we don't have a problem with the 850, right? Would you also not have a problem with, do you have a problem with all infrastructure investments that we are spending now for the long-term benefit of the city? So part of that EMA money is... Those projects that Chris presented to us, those capital improvement projects, right? Yes. Okay.
Yes.
So, now target's on your head, buddy. So these projects that he brought to us, we're doing now because they are projects that we needed to do at some point, right? We're talking street stuff and some of these other projects.
We'll pull up Chris's presentation.
Yeah. Okay.
513, so you can see the.
Right,
so
I want to see.
I've got all the projects.
Right. Yeah, so that's do you have a problem, David and Rodney and Mike and Ron and Bill? Do you all have a problem with all these capital expenditures, or are there some of them that you think we should be investing the city and borrowed money now, but we should for some things but not other things?
That's exactly the issue.
Okay. I'm trying to limit it down. So it's okay with us to borrow money from our savings to invest in our infrastructure for some things but not others. And that's fine if that's the judgment call we want to make. But let's be clear here, we're all happy with quality of life investments on money that isn't coming in this year. I'm happy with investments in street and stormwater and other that aren't necessarily coming in this year, because I think we invest in the city when the economy's good and the economy's still pretty good. But if we need to cut out some of those, let's be clear why we're cutting them out, and let's cut out some of this other stuff. Why don't you want to make these investments? Because that's what we're talking about.
Well, it's a simple comparison of priorities. They're all very compelling.
Right.
They're all essential to the needs of the city.
No, I got it. And we all understand. I think we understand the problem now. It took me a minute. We're there. So what's the judgment call we need to make?
We need to see these improvements.
Sure.
Okay. Trails 350.
Yeah, we like trails.
Which?
Before you get into that, I think it's a bigger picture problem in that, Ben. Now we're all we're doing is stepping backwards and going to go back and look at the individual areas that we've already increased them all, and say we're going to pick on individual projects as to what's more important than the other. The bottom line on this is that we have to not spend 3.5% of the budget overall.
Okay, but that's where the money is.
Go back and I mean, it seems like we're missing the point. We're going backwards in terms of. Well, go ahead.
I'm trying to find the money, and this is where the money is.
Number one, the fairest way to find it is just to take it across the board. Everybody pays. We can just eliminate one entire project and get there, but are you willing to take that? Are you going to do that? Find one $3 million project in the budget, and let's just take it out.
Yeah. Or find $3 million more in revenue.
Well, I just spent my whole weekend working on trying to do that.
Number one, the this project is...
That's the Broadway. We put that money towards the Broadway trail.
Okay.
That's the Broadway sidewalk.
Right.
Sure.
Well, and what we...
Then we just spend it again by reappropriating it.
Okay, so
Which is my point earlier. We've spent the same money twice.
Okay, well...
Okay.
Isn't this last year's money?
No, this is new budgeted money.
No, the money we spent tonight is... Or, no, the money we didn't spend tonight was...
Okay.
Anyway, go ahead. What else? So we've already agreed that those...
We have some design to do on the landfill.
Yeah.
And we have a retaining wall at the library.
Mm-hmm.
Pretty easy. Start lopping them.
I mean,
keep us a running tab, ladies, if you would. One of them start with. Go back two slides.
Go back two slides.
A cell and a library retaining wall. We go over there and bolster it and try to make some local repairs without this appropriation. There's $200,000. Next.
Where's our.
I'm only trying to make a comparison. I'm not suggesting these are the cuts you make. I want to show you how you identify funds.
We understand how we identify funds, Eric. I don't want to start making a checklist that we're not actually making right now for the sake of
but
making
But that's
a
what
point.
You're telling us to do. And that's what we do every day after you guys give us this two-handed guidance. It's not. That's what it comes to.
I understand, Eric. So we're trying to actually not make the point now. We're trying to find the money. If we're going to find the money, we can do it two ways. We can cut out specific projects. Or we can take David's route and do an across-the-board haircut.
Well, the across-the-board haircut is mismatched because some funds don't have to give.
Sure, and then that's your problem to figure out at the staff level, but we get to say we did it here.
And what it comes back to is that we go down and we look at these projects and we come back and make proposals, and you have sacred cows.
Hey, I'm happy to. I mean, I think that we need to be not saying.
Well, let me take that back. I'm asking my staff to do this as you're talking about it. So as we identify these projects in here, they are counting them up. We'll then coordinate those and bring them back to you for consideration. I'm not going to bring it back on you tonight.
Didn't on the $350,000 Crossland Trail, can't we eliminate that? We just brought it from the Rainy Day Fund, right?
Well, no, because we would, at that point, have just cut out the East Side Broadway Trail extension. No, we did because we did rot it because it was $350,000 that... was prior to Crossland, we decided, hey, let's not do Crossland, let's do Broadway so the east side of town can get some trails.
Well, in addition, let's run through these capital improvement funds and just, you can see where the money goes.
Okay. Obviously, we have the landfill cell, the retaining wall. Did you want any rebuttal or recommendation of any sort?
Just identify where it's going.
The landfill
is an internal counter here.
How imminent is the landfill design?
I'd have to get back with you, because we could go through every one of these and take a long time.
Okay.
ADA is the one that we're directed to do through the judgment. That's a must do. Okay. The ramps on Broadway.
Well, a must do to the tune of how much per year?
$300,000 per year.
How much do we have? No kidding. In this budget, that's twice that.
In this budget?
Yeah. Because we have ADA.
We have three ADA projects. We have three ADA projects. We have the one that we're required to do, which is the first one on there, the $300,000. We have the $295,000 that was delayed from last year because we did mill and overlay and we did a reconstruction of one block of Broadway. We took the money out of that particular mill and overlay to fund the other pieces to make that work. That's what we did last year. We also have another ADA project in the ramps where we have to go back and address where we put new equipment. So basically,
$900,000.
So,
roughly.
And we're obligated to spend $300,000. Nothing's off the table, Chris.
Correct.
I actually disagree with that because some of these projects have already been done and the ADA portion of it has not been done. These projects triggered last year what now you're going to have to fund this year.
Which we knew was going to happen.
Right.
Yes.
So, sorry, I wasn't yelling, but I mean, these are triggered already.
How does that change any way you talk to me?
Well, this time it's in public. So, I mean, I would argue that anything that's already been triggered is off the table. I think that just like fire and police, you're going to have to set that to the side and figure out somewhere else to get the money.
I'll take that stance for now, Council.
Okay.
What's next, Chris?
Here's the roof to the convention hall.
Probably last $600,000.
Yeah.
Here we have the Meadow Lake Golf Course restroom, which is a rebuild.
Or in the trees.
How
60?
Excuse me?
Yeah, I mean, how necessary? I mean, we've got, oh no, it burned, didn't it?
It won't affect you because it's a women's restroom.
Yeah. It doesn't affect me at all.
Ron said he didn't even know it was out there. So.
Yeah. Well, these numbers there and keep put them all
this,
in the
this would category. Be something you'd have to settle for an operational cost to put in a chem toilet. The Wilshire retaining wall. Okay.
Been there every year that I've been here.
The TIF funding on 66th Street.
No point to do anything with that.
Willow Road is 1.4.
That's not.
Wait,
that's all TIF money. That's not
included in
our number.
No. The Willow, only the 66th Street is the TIF.
Right.
So the 1.4 from Willow.
That's not a number that we can take out because it's coming from TIF money.
Exactly. So the 66th Street reconstruction doesn't buy you anything. Willow Road.
Now let's talk about Willow Road.
Yes.
We're currently purchasing right away so that we can move
utilities.
Utilities.
We have.
Now this funds only that acquisition and move of utilities, right?
This funds the remaining two properties and the moving of utilities.
Now I'm just asking. If we delay that project by a year, how does it affect our state matching funds?
It's first on the list. We'd have to move it to third on the list, and we wouldn't get state funds.
So you have?
But
here's a very real consideration.
It is a very real consideration.
Do you want to widen Willow or not? That's a question that we need to ask. Next one.
Next. Cleveland and Chestnut intersection. This is a $1 million project to acquire the right-of-way and to move the utilities under it. This is at the intersection where we did the PUD last summer.
Which is supporting a $35 million investment in our community.
Correct.
Okay.
And
so
the next
then,
one
then you
down.
Got this Cleveland Street Boulevard, which is lumped in the same thing.
That is basically the same thing.
Absolutely
that is from
right.
Chestnut to the railroad track.
So next.
Crack seal. Railroad
$100,000. This is a way. You know, these are the railroad upgrades. These are, you know, let's put those on the list, Aaron.
They're on the list.
So the railroad on that last one, our 10% share is $110,000.
That is correct.
Yeah, they're very expensive crossings.
These crossings run $150 to $180 to improve. And we get about $35,000 bill.
Now, if the railroad doesn't do their portion, and
if the state and the feds do not do their portion, we have
don't
no
have
expense.
To spend it.
If we do not contribute money, they won't do it.
You hit that railroad hard enough on 66, you get elevated.
Next one, Chris.
The Rupin Boggy Creek. This is coming out of what I believe are the GO bonds.
Yes, that
so
money is
cutting,
available, but it has to be spent only on.
On bridges.
So you can't spend it anywhere else.
So there's no benefit to cutting this one. There's benefit if you will, but you don't gain from it. ADA in the parks. We have the Ferris wheel. Reconstruction and overlay, 1.7.
You know, here's an area where you could take $500,000. And it's going to come out in next year's. You get those complaints about roads, you understand that we're driving ourselves there. Take $500,000 off there. We're just doing some gross accounting now. Bear with me.
I understand.
Thanks,
basically, what we would do is we would either relocate the water line or do overlay Washington from, or overlay Broadway from Washington to Second. That's how you'd cut that.
I know it's just shuffling money, but I would think that we could do the Ferris wheel pad within the money that we allocated tonight.
That's kind of below the radar at the moment, Commissioner, yeah. But I agree with you.
Sanitary sewer for the canola plant. This is a TIF. You don't get any benefit. 54th Street relief line.
Let me ask a question about the TIF funding, though. That may be TIF money we're spending, but don't we have cash outlay for
engineering design,
TIF consulting?
Yes, yes.
Finance package to put, I mean, there are $300,000 or $500,000 of that.
Yep.
So that's that right. Could come out of this year because we're not actually going to do that. But 66th Street, we're not going to lay that this year. So if we just delayed the TIF funding because we don't need the money yet, could we not save several hundred there?
We're not really going to save anything if we do that, because if we take that out, we would also take it out of revenue, Commissioner, and we would still be at the same net.
You're counting those expenses in the revenue.
Okay. Yes, Commissioner.
All right, I got that.
Okay, 54th Street relief line, that's a sanitary sewer project.
That one is the one that crosses over.
That is the one that runs from
crossing street.
From 412 to the 54th Street lift station. This is the one that provides us the capability to extend or to expand further north and east of this location, which is 54th and 412.
Just leave it on there for now. Next one.
Meadow Lake Sanitary Sewer. That's the one that's has shown signs of shifting. It's a gamble.
Is this the one that's underneath the buildings?
No, sir.
Okay.
This is a sanitary sewer line that crosses one of the tributaries to the Middle Lake, and it moved last summer when we had that big rain. The foundation moved, and so we put it on the list.
Okay. But it's not necessarily going to explode tomorrow.
If it does, it'll cost a whole lot more to repair it. Is that a downside? It's a judgment call. That one, I'm pretty confident we need to leave in there. The INI, can you reduce that to 500,000?
You could. I have to ask whether you get actual benefit from that.
No.
Because it's out of the sanitary sewer fund.
It can't be used anywhere else.
You don't really benefit from that.
Okay. It can be unless you decide to change the ordinance. It's based on an ordinance that you passed. So same way with the stormwater.
Yeah. Okay. So root control, we know that that's a standing problem. That's underfunded as it is.
Yes. This one, if we forego... If we forgo reuse into the coke plant, we might be able to do it in a temporary situation to get them to buy off on it.
We could slide it by a year and keep $125,000 in for engineering and design.
And
because coke's at this point, coke's requirement may have slid as much as 6 months.
Well, and I'm wondering if that could be included in the TIF funding. You know,
for the canola plant.
It's not our.
Oh, right. That's
it's county TIF.
I'm sorry. I sit on that.
Can we send them a bill?
Absolutely. Doesn't bother me any. We could look at.
This is a critical element of the strategy to reuse water to coke, but it doesn't necessarily have to be spent this year. Chris, could it wait a year?
If we forego providing reuse to them. And depending on what DEQ says, possibly. This is part of the strategy of getting more water into the city, saving water where we can, using reuse to feed coke for a little bit while we go find more water.
Okay, well let's.
But this is also that.
I mean, they're all important.
They're all important.
But this is that chlorination building that we chlorinated, sent it to them.
Yes.
They chlorinated again.
Yes.
Okay, so why don't we left $250,000 on there for now?
Sounds like a plan.
Now yeah.
Let's move to
another. I can do it.
When you're saying this year, do you mean 2014 to...
2014-15.
Comes the budget that we're working on.
You don't get any... They don't get any benefit from stormwater either, do they?
Stormwater, we could cut, but...
It's a protected...
The revenue is still going to be transferred over because that's what the ordinance tells us to do.
Yeah, and this body has the power to change.
Absolutely.
That is true.
Well, only four of you. Only takes four votes, we can change that.
Well, at this point,
but
I want to get an aggregate sum and then see where we stand. There are other considerations.
But keep in mind, that has to be a conscious decision, because these are the things that we do over the long term for that next big rain.
Now, that detention, that tributary construction there, that's the one that crosses under Willow by Prairie School?
Yes. Okay. You could delay this a year. Pretty close. Pretty easily. Or scale it back some.
And
the Oakwood is this detention facility right here. Stormwater master plan. This is the one where we look at the basin out on the east side where we're getting all our industrial development. Chestnut West is this one right here. This is where Garland Trib is. This is Chestnut West. We bought that property. I believe the design is actually complete. It would be a matter of doing some construction. Rolling Oaks Detention. Yeah. This is finishing up Rolling Oaks, which is at Chestnut and Cleveland, that whole section with Gene Anderson.
Another that gets hand in hand with the other ones that we protect.
It is.
Okay.
And water. We have the water line to Coke.
It's TIF.
TIF. We have the alternate water source. Probably could please clear a little off of this. Well improvement. This is one that I would probably suggest that we not touch at this time.
Would that be one that we could ditch out of the budget, and if you actually come up with water that we can buy, do supplemental appropriations?
Well, we just bought that much this year, or pushing that much. We didn't think we could, and the opportunity presented two properties. That we bought, so.
Yeah.
13, 14.
And now, you tell me if well-filled water acquisition was an overwhelming priority last year, if that's changed, then we'll take $250,000 off of it.
I think it's still a priority.
Aaron, take $250,000 off of it.
Well, I'm sorry, what was that, David?
Wait for the contracts.
I think we wait for the contract.
Well filled.
Did you want to take $250 off alternate water supply as well?
Yes.
Run to one alternate down to $500. Water rights acquisition.
Take $150 off of it.
Take $150 off. Fire hydrant maintenance.
Required. It has to be in place. We're losing the opportunity for development.
We are losing business because of these two.
Both of them have to be protected. Next one.
Street and alley.
This is the one that you guys hear the most about. This is where we bottle.
Well, Tammy's not here, so we can just get rid of all of that.
Did you catch that?
Looks like 1.7 out of street now.
Can we shave $250,000 off that without breaking any hearts?
Take $210,000 and make it 1.5, and then we
let's make it a 1.5.
Take more than that.
Now, Jim, what does public work mean? I'm drawing a blank on what that is.
This is what they use. This is the funding that they use to go do all the unimproved roads, to grade them, to rock them.
That's right.
And every time somebody bothers you. And you call him, he goes fix it with the money.
Yeah, and that needs to stay there. We have a very good plan.
Is that pretty accurate, Jim?
Pretty accurate.
That usually starts with one of us.
Chris, what's your next one there?
Sidewalk partnership program. We already cut these in half from this previous year.
That's correct.
Cut them out again.
It's no money
anywhere. Small policy.
And then there's a sidewalk that we're going to construct at 16th and
those don't amount to
Birch.
Not enough to manage.
Oh, that's it.
So, Aaron, what's that grand total that we've identified for cuts?
Read the list to us, Aaron, so we know what all that is and what's the total.
Well, if you would, just give me a grand total first. Well, how much did we save?
I think we lost her.
It's difficult to try and capture what we're
doing. Okay.
In my mind, we were at about 3.7. Just rough math.
This total deal.
We can get there.
Now, this is what we're giving up. I mean, we're giving up these projects that.
This is what we're doing to make a fiscally responsible budget. We're not giving up. We're doing the right thing for the taxpayers.
If you're
making priorities, and we're making the hard decisions.
And if your revenue increases in 6 months, that's your mid-year review, you can restate those cuts.
Absolutely.
I like that. Next year at this time, with all this extra money, we'll be paid in the streets.
Allow us then to go back as staff, coordinate those cuts, and bring you back new projections. And with your indulgence, I'd also like to dabble into the protected funds. Not police and fire, but the other funds that we've identified as
which funds are those?
Well, there's an array of them. There's
Stormwater, your stormwater and sanitary sewer are the major ones.
We'll identify those decisions that will need further action by changing of an ordinance. So, Mr. Mayor, I think that's all we can accomplish on the budget this evening. We're going to have to give you the rest of this number before you can make a decision.
So we're going to need an extra meeting. Do we need to set that up? We're not going to be ready June 3rd just to vote.
Pardon me, sir?
We can't kick this to June 3rd or we'll be having this discussion at the next meeting.
We will indeed. Now, you have a special meeting on Thursday, which we haven't posted that yet, have we, Amber? Can we adjust it, though? Can we modify it?
We've got about 12 hours to adjust.
You get that done by
tomorrow. Okay, good. We can change it until 9 o'clock tomorrow. So, if you give us an extra hour on that, you know, you have two presentations that we're giving you an hour. I don't think you'll take that long. But if you give us give us 30 minutes at the end of that, and we'll bring this back to you. And all we're going to show you is the impacts of these decisions tonight. Is that fair enough?
Yep. Yeah. On Thursday.
Yes. We'll piggyback onto that meeting.
I have a question.
It's one.
Under the EMA Fund 31, you show a projected balance at the end of next year of $69 million. How much of that's in cash? Now, to me, cash and assets that aren't cash are apples and oranges.
Mayor, I don't have that answer right now. I'm going to have to.
Does that make sense?
I'm going to have to look it up. So if you would let me bring that answer back to you at our meeting on Thursday, or I can email it to you tomorrow or tonight. I just need to get to my computer where I can see.
Thursday's fine, Gerald. Okay. But that's almost $70 million sitting there.
Yeah, it's not all cash, I can tell you that, but there is a significant amount.
If half of it's cash, that's $35 million.
Yes, remember, a lot of that's restricted for debt, but I'll have you an answer soon.
Fair later enough.
Thursday.
Thank you. Do we have a motion on the floor?
I don't even remember. No.
Apparently not. An hour ago, I forgot.
I don't think there's any motion on the table.
Brian, do you have a motion on the floor?
No, not that I know of.
Look, any of them got a second.
I could bring Rogo up again.
Next, consent.
It's serious to save $40,000.
It's the closest we've ever been.
Be on consent. And yeah.
Consent.
Consent items, aren't
item
we?
Nine. Yep.
We're headed for consent items, item number 9.
Move to approve.
Motion by Mann to approve.
Mayor, I would like to get a little bit of information about 9/11.
I think we need a second.
I'll second the motion.
Motion and a second. Ron, which one?
9/11.
9/11, okay.
I'd be willing to approve all of them but that one.
Chris, can you speak to this?
Yes.
This is that water line on Independence and Main.
This is
the water line that...
This is the award to NOAA Sanitary Sewer along Independence?
Yes.
Correct.
The reason that I'm asking about this is the one that has delayed the relocation of the Boomer statue.
That is correct.
And I've had a number of people contact me, you know, they're concerned about it not being resurrected. And I'm just curious about, you mentioned to me that this is going to be awarded within 30 days?
Yes. This is on the agenda for approval.
Yes, yes. And then after that, you think that to complete this project will be another 60 days?
That is correct.
And that's a pretty quick timeline, Commissioner.
Yes, it is.
So
now,
then we're talking about this being completed by what?
June, July, the end of August.
90 days.
My concern is that as a drop-dead date, I think that that statue needs to be back in place before the Cherokee Strip zone.
Well, okay.
This is what, mid-September?
If this project is completed in August, as we anticipate, we'll have 2 weeks to place that statue. We can do all the preparation for the base and all that. So all you got to do is pick up Boomer's big behind.
That's what I'd like for us to do.
And God love us, let's make sure that that statue is more important than a sanitary sewer line that serves the whole downtown.
As you'll notice, this is the plaza right here, where you're planning on putting the horse. And what we'll have to do is we'll have to build a pit right there at Cherokee as we bore that. So we're pretty much going to be doing construction right there on the east lanes of Independence, just about right there.
Okay, and I'm assuming that whoever we contract with, we can rely on to not destroy everything within 50 yards.
They're pretty good at it.
I mean, are you talking about any place where we've had this type of construction to where, you know, buildings on the periphery just, you know, were damaged?
None that I'm aware of.
Anyway,
I know we all
have our priorities, and a lot of people don't consider, you know, Boomer to be any priority at all, but I think it is, and I think there are other people that do. So.
Well, for me, it's a question of protecting the statue while we're doing construction in that particular area.
Well, the statue could, of course, have been put up, you know, well ahead of this. We've deliberately delayed it, waiting for this, and it's been awfully slow to materialize.
But you have to balance that, Commissioner, against what could happen if we damage that, or if we put it in place and we have to move it. We didn't know any of the impacts of this contract until we were ready to present it to you tonight. Now, we'll get this done by August, and Boomer will be there by September 15th.
But okay. The prep work can be done. At the same time,
I just don't want to move that statue across an open hole in the ground, and that's what it's going to mean.
As far as
open hole there now.
As far as timeline is concerned, this has been pretty much on time to what we normally do. From the initiation to design to bidding to award.
Okay, I'm still concerned about.
Have we agreed on which direction he faces?
Yeah, he's going.
You can put it up either way. It doesn't make any difference to me, just as long as it's there.
Commissioner, you have my commitment that if it is humanly possible, if it is anything within our power, Boomer will be in place before the Cherokee Strip Days Parade. You can. The desire expressed to me was to dedicate it on that day anyway. So we'll have him there.
All right. You heard it here.
So,
further discussion. Can we approve all the consent items now? Do we have to pull that one out? And
sure, why not?
You can approve them all.
Who made the motion?
Me.
Ben.
David.
David, second it. Please cast your vote. Motion carries 6-0. Item 10, we will now recess to convene as the Enid Municipal Authority. Item 11, trustees of the Enid Municipal Authority regular meeting are all in attendance except for Tammy Wilson. Item 12, the Enid Municipal Authority regular meeting is now in session. Item 12.1, conduct a public hearing on the proposed fiscal year 2014-2015 financial plan.
Chairman and trustees, this is exactly what we did earlier. It's just an EMA while you're convened as those trustees. So it's an opportunity for anybody who wants to talk about the EMA budget, which we'll be talking about again on Thursday.
I can wait.
I don't know if there's anybody signed up to talk on it.
No.
Right, so
thank goodness.
That person has already spoken. So we just pass on to item 12.2. Discuss and take necessary action on the fiscal year 2014-2015 Enid Municipal Authority financial plan.
Yes, this one we're going to bring back to you, lopping off about $3.2 million, of course, what we talked about on Thursday.
Okay.
Item 12.4.
Three.
Consider a contract for water rights exploration and from Jason Bradley Dietrich, Ringwood, Oklahoma. Project number W-1304A.
Second.
Motion by David, second by
Ron.
Further discussion? Please cast your vote. Motion carries 6-0. Item 12.4, approval of claims in the amount of 307,000, $149.52.
So moved.
Motion by Mike.
Second.
Second by Ron. Please cast your vote. Motion carries 6-0. Item 13, we will now adjourn to convene as the Enid Economic Development Authority. Trustees of the Enid Economic Development Authority in the regular meeting are all present except for Tammy Wilson, who is absent. Item 15, Enid Economic Development Authority regular meeting is now in session. Item 15.1, conduct a public hearing on the proposed fiscal year 2014-2015 financial plan for the Enid Economic Development Authority.
Gerald? This is the same thing, Chairman and trustees, as you're convening the EDA. It's an opportunity for anybody to talk about EDA budget, if there's anybody that wants to talk about it. I certainly don't want to anymore.
Was that 15-1 or 15-2?
That was 15-1.
15-2, the same case?
Yes. Yes, Mayor, we will take it up again on Thursday.
Moving on to 15-3, approval of claims in the amount of $0.
I move.
I was going to leave that one for you, Rodney.
This will be known as the Rodney Tim.
Can he second his own motion?
You can take credit for all of it.
You know, I didn't see that previously. Number 16, we'll adjourn to reconvene.
We should probably vote on that other deal.
Do we have to vote on nothing?
Sure. Yes.
Let's go through the motions.
Yes.
Yes.
I second it.
Wait a minute. Do we have to vote on nothing?
If you have a motion and a second, yes.
Who made the motion?
Rodney.
How could you?
And I second.
You got to be kidding.
No, I don't.
Who wouldn't approve it? I mean, you know.
Well, let's vote.
Yes.
Who seconded the motion? Who seconded?
I did.
Mike Stuber.
Yes.
Oh. Motion carries 5-1. Item 16. We will now adjourn to reconvene as the Enid City Commission. Under item 17, public discussion. Right. There is no one Ebert. Signed up. Item 18, do I have a motion to adjourn?
I'll make that motion.
Second.
Motion by Mike, second by
Ben.
Please cast your vote.
No.
Motion carries 6-0.
Thank you for joining us for the Enid City Commission meeting. If you have any questions or comments, visit our website at enid.org.